This is the Discover Car Countdown to Green as we get ready to go racing.
The 43-car field lined up at Watkins Glen. On Friday, rain and track conditions forced cancellation of qualifying. The grid was set by the rule book, putting the potent combination of Jimmy Johnson and Jeff Gordon on the front row. At this 2.45-mile road course, the race really begins in the first turn and doesn't end until you've made it through the last one. Today, the race to the chase takes a spin at Watkins Glen. The clock is ticking. Five races remain in the race to the chase, and those still in the hunt know it's time to make their move. But at Watkins Glen, one wrong move and their chances may be stopped. Cold. Last week at Indy, everyone learned that no point lead is a sure thing.
The championship leader is in trouble.
Is it a blowout?
Oh, yeah.
This week at the Glen, everyone knows that finishing is no sure thing.
Jeff Gordon is spun coming to the checkered flag. He's not going to make it to the start-finish line.
Today, the race to the chase takes some wicked turns, and the outcome may be a bit twisted. But that's just racing at the Glen. TNT Sports presents the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series, live from the road course at Watkins Glen, New York. Because the field was set by the rule book, the guys at the top of the championship standings are at the front of the field. That means when the green flag flies, everybody really is chasing the guy in front of them. Hi, everybody. The TNT race family welcomes you to the Glen. I'm Bill Weber. How tight is that race to the chase for the Nextel Cup? Well, if Elliott Sadler doesn't oversleep and starts this race, he's sixth on the grid and sixth in the standings, he cannot fall out of the top 10. But the guy seventh through 10th could. That's Kurt Busch, Bobby Labonte, Kevin Harvick, and Ryan Newman. And that could open the door for the guys 11th through 15th. And if you take four-time Watkins Glen winner Jeff Gordon out of the mix, the other nine guys in the top 10 in the championship standings have combined for 87 road course starts, but just 32 top 10 finishes. This could be a wild day. Let's go. Marty Snyder bats leadoff.
Well, Bill, the first of the outsiders, if you will, Casey Kane, 11th in the championship standings, just 31 out of the chase for the championship. But you're a Watkins Glen rookie, so what are the realistic goals today, Casey?
Oh, it's to stay on the course, not get off the track, and keep the transmission in it. We need to finish the race today, and I think our Dodge dealers, your AW Dodge, is a pretty decent car. They worked on it last night, so hopefully it'll be pretty good today.
Starting 11th, trying to keep a string of three straight top 10s alive today. Matt Yoakum.
Jamie McMurray enters Watkins Glen fourth in the championship standings, just 109 markers out of the top 10. Now, this could be the biggest day for you over the next five races. You've got to average 22 more points than Ryan Newman. Big day today. Is this where you've got to make your push?
Yeah, I mean, I look at a road course kind of like you would at a super speedway or something that this could be a really big points day. Guys could struggle here, get run off course, get stuck in a gravel trap, and you could make up a lot of ground on them. So I ran really well at Sonoma. The fact that we didn't get to practice on Friday hurt our team a little bit because I'm not as good here as what I was at Sonoma. But car was good in happy hour and made some adjustments this morning. Start in a pretty good position. I think we're 14th or something, so far enough
right
front. Yeah, I mean, you kind of know who you're racing, so hopefully we can have a good day and don't wish bad luck on anybody, but just hope we can finish well.
He finished 22nd here 1 year ago, but did finish second earlier this season at Sonoma. Today, Burns.
Matt, Mark Martin is 15th in the championship, just 123 points out of 10th, with still a chance at the chase. Mark, is Watkins Glen where you guys make your move?
Yeah, we've been making our move.
Trying to make your move, right?
Yeah, we've been doing it. Every time we get within about 60 or 70 points, something happens, and we go back to 125. So that's been a disappointment for us. But I'm so proud of the whole Viagra team. They've had me in Tarses that run up front every week, and, man, that makes it all worthwhile.
But with three wins here at Watkins Glen, Mark Martin has been very good. Now, last year, Robbie Gordon, well, he was thoroughly good.
Yeah. Second win of the season for Robbie Gordon, the Road King, today at Watkins Glen.
And Robbie Gordon wants to keep that crown. Welcome to the wagon. How are you?
I'm doing good. We lost at Sonoma to Jeff, and him starting up front here is gonna be a tough job for us today.
Yeah, how are you gonna defend starting 23rd?
The best I've run starting that far back, in 2000 we started dead last, and we finished fourth.
Yeah.
So it can be done. You can get to the front.
Hopefully. How do you do it?
How do you do it? Methodically. Be careful with the front fenders. This is a fast racetrack. Our average speeds are up in the 125 mile an hour range, and downforce makes a big deal, a big difference. And if I knock one of those fenders in, car's gonna get tight, and I can't do that. So I just gotta make every pass methodical, clean, smooth pass so that we can get one car at a time and still have a good car left when we have to race Jeff.
You have a favorite place to pass here?
Oh, I think you can pass in a lot of places. It's where you set the guy up at. And if he thinks you're going to go around the outside and you go and he moves outside, then you go inside. There's opportunities to pass at probably four places on this racetrack. Our car's very fast up through the S-turns, which puts us in a position going into the chicane. Think, you know, obviously turn one's a good passing zone. I think we have a good race car. Our car was very fast in practice. I did 10 laps in a row, and I think we were about the only car that did a long run. And we did 10 in a row, and the car was still just as fast at the end of the run as it was at the beginning.
Okay, don't miss that chicane over there, okay?
Yeah, we missed the chicane. That'd be a big deal. But, you know, if you miss the chicane with two tires,
yeah,
it's pretty good.
All right. Thanks for coming up. Best of luck today.
Thanks.
Robbie Gordon, defending champ here at the Glen. Here's a look at the top 20 in the standings heading into today's race. Jimmy Johnson lost 135 points at Indy. Gordon has won three of the last six races. That's Jeff Gordon. And in the last seven races, Earnhardt has lost 298 points to Johnson. It's just 219 points from fourth to 10th. And here come the outsiders. Kane, 31 out of 10th. And 15th place, Mark Martin, just 196 points out of 7th. That's the first lap. Here's what's coming up on the Discover Card Countdown to Green. Safety is the number one issue in NASCAR. We'll look at the changes made in the last year. Dave discovers the future with a look at the car of tomorrow. Benny gets fired up for the big garage grill-off. And Wally shows us how to win at the Glen. All that and Jeff Gordon coming up on the Discover Card Countdown to Green. Earnhardt Jr. starts third today. He finished third last year at this track, his only top 10 finish in 9 road course races. In his 7 road course starts, Kurt Busch has just one top 10 finish and has never had one in 3 races here. 1 year ago here, we took a look at some of the safety issues in Nextel Cup racing. Now, a year later, another look. Changes in the cars, around the tracks, and in the rule book have made a dramatic difference in how safe drivers feel in a sport that will always be dangerous.
Listen, if you compare us to where we were 2 years ago, we're light years ahead of that. We are light years ahead of that. There is no question.
Our whole sport's made a very strong effort to learn and understand what takes place in a crash. We've learned what needs to be in the driver's cockpit, the seat belts, the head and neck devices. We've implemented soft walls. I mean, there's been a lot of data and a lot of real information pulled together to come up with some solid safety devices that I think are working great.
The installation of the safer barrier, or softer wall, has been well received by race drivers and race officials.
Traditionally, we see 50% reduction in G-forces when a car hits the safer barrier as opposed to a concrete wall, which is huge. That's a huge number. But you also see, I think, more cars pull away from an accident and drive back to the garage. I think you're seeing more of that happen on the racetrack now than you would if we were still exposed to the concrete walls.
In the Nextel Cup Series, drivers stop racing when the caution flag comes out, a long-awaited and welcome change.
You know, they've become a total lack of respect out there for what had taken place for a lot of years. And I realize there's change all the time. And, you know, NASCAR had warned us a number of times that if we weren't going to continue with what was a gentleman's agreement from a lot of years prior, that they were going to step in and take action. And that's why we have what we have.
It is a better rule. There's no question. It gives the safety personnel a chance to roll quicker. It gives the guys in the tower to tell them to roll quicker. You know, even to the point where we're so aware of it now that you'll see cars slow down on the racetrack to let a safety
car get up to to a wreck.
I think that's big. I think not only is it safer for the competitors as they're racing, but it's so much safer for the competitor that has been in an accident. The cars are slowing down, and I think the safety crews are able to get to them a little bit faster.
But the bottom line remains, racing is dangerous. The goal, never let up in the race to make the sport safer.
We don't think about what we do as dangerous. We think about what we do as a sport. And we also understand the realities of the dangers within the sport. But when I pull into Pocono or Indianapolis or to New Hampshire, what I'm thinking about is, what are we going to need to do this weekend to win?
We choose to put ourselves in those situations, knowing that we're professionals, knowing that we do everything that we possibly can to be safe and to make the car safer. But it's never going to be enough. It's never going to be absolutely safe. We're racing cars at 200 miles per hour. What more can you say?
NASCAR now has a team of doctors available for consultation, and they travel a medical liaison to every race. No offense, but the drivers hope they don't see those people very often. As for a safer future, well, the key could be the car of tomorrow.
I think the next one big thing is car design. There's a tremendous effort on car design, how we can build a more competitive race car, at the same time build a more safe race car.
Well, Dave Burns has seen the car of the future. Dave, what's the future look like?
It looks pretty good, Bill, and I took our cameras with me when I saw it so that our fans at home could see as well. Inside NASCAR's Research and Development Center, we find what they are calling the car of tomorrow. Let me show you why it should increase safety and competition for years to come. First, to driver safety in the cockpit. They'll now be moved over 4.5 inches toward the center of the car, away from this door bar. In an impact, that can be important. If they do wreck, getting out of the car is important as well. 2 more inches this direction, 4 inches this way, easier to escape. That naturally increases this area here we refer to as the greenhouse. It's now a bit bulkier and harder to get through the air, especially at the super speedways. It'll slow them down a little, but it'll be safer and better for competition. One more area. At the back of the car, the rear bumper will be lowered 3.5 inches. NASCAR drivers like to make contact. Now, if they do nose to tail, they have less potential for wrecking each other. And in addition, NASCAR is looking at adding crushable material to that rear bumper. In fact, all around the race car, materials like this aluminum honeycomb, which is strong and lightweight, yet can crush in a crash and absorb energy bill, making it safer for the drivers.
Okay, Dave, so when does the future arrive?
Well, NASCAR is saying mid to late 2005. The new car cannot race against the old car, so they want to phase it in slowly, probably at a restrictor plate track or even at this Watkins Glen road course.
Thanks a lot, Dave. Rusty Wallace is a 2-time winner at this Watkins Glen road course. He celebrated his 48th birthday yesterday. He starts 17th. Kyle Petty won here in 1992. Today he makes career start number 700, rolling off 33rd. Cover card, countdown to green, races on at Watkins Glen. Jeremy Mayfield is 12th on the grid. He's raced here 9 times and was 3rd in 2001. Dale Jarrett's best finish here in 17 starts, 4th in 1999. He starts lucky 13th. Now, this race hasn't even started yet, but all week long, people have been talking about what's going to happen when it's over. Jeff Gordon's finish line celebration at Indianapolis was fun for some, but frustrating for others. This week, Gordon and car owner Rick Hendrick sent an apology to the Indianapolis Motor Speedway for not carrying on the tradition of pulling into victory lane. Gordon told me here on Friday that he had planned to get back in the car and drive to victory lane, but things just got out of control. Nothing was said at the drivers' meeting this morning, but during the week, NASCAR, in their subtle fashion, made it clear that victory lane protocol will be followed. Jeff Burton has started 292 races for Roush Racing. Today it's number 293 and his last for Roush Racing. On Friday, Burton formally announced that beginning next week at Michigan, he will drive the 30 car for car owner Richard Childress. Burton has 17 career wins. He has struggled this season in an unsponsored ride. He makes the shift from Ford to Chevrolet. And right now he's standing by with Matt.
Jeff Burton riding around the racetrack for the final time wearing a Roush uniform. Jeff, how difficult the decision to leave after so many good years?
Well, it was a tough decision that I had to face for sure. I have a tremendous amount of respect for Roush Racing. At the same time, I'm real excited about my opportunity with Richard Childress Racing. So I'll get going tomorrow and try to get that AOL car up front.
How difficult, also looking at the fact that you have so many friends there?
Well, I do have a lot of friends there, and I have a tremendous amount of respect for a lot of people there. I'm leaving a company, but I'm not going to leave my friends, and you know, that's really how it is. We work well together, but we also talk socially together, and that won't change.
Time to move on?
I don't know. You know, part of me thinks it is, and then part of me certainly sees the improvements that we've made. We've been running pretty well the last 2 months, and I'm actually leaving at a time when I think we've been the best we've been for a couple years, so that's difficult. Carl Edwards will step in and do a great job. I think the team is poised to do a good job. So it was a difficult decision to make because I think temporarily I was doing really well, but long-term I think it's the right thing for me.
And he would love to go out a winner today, making his 18th road course start in a Jack Roush Ford. He's never won on a road course. Bill?
Thanks, Matt. Now, one thing every racer wants is a clean grill. That way, when the competition really gets cooking, you can give your machine all the gas it needs without any fear of overheating. Well, that's exactly what happened when the Emeril Lagasses of the garage got together for a charity barbecue. And when Benny Parsons heard about that, he said to himself, "Self, that's a race I need to see."
So what's going on here? Tell me what's going on.
This is the Crew Chef Challenge. It's a cooking competition for all the NASCAR team members or crew chefs.
What are you making?
I'm making three types of pizza: traditional pizza, barbecue pizza, and a fruit pizza. And you're tasting it.
We got lemon pepper chicken, stir fry, vegetable stir fry for a good, healthy nourishment.
Kenny, we're going to somebody else. You talk about healthy nourishment. We got to go find somebody else. Gee, melt in your mouth steak. What is that?
It's steak that I've been marinating since Monday.
Crab meat and a steak?
Yep, filet mignon, mushrooms in a burgundy wine sauce, asparagus.
You're killing me, man, you're killing me.
Looky here, looky here.
Well, I'll just take one, you know, just to be sociable. It is good. Can you raise any money doing this?
Yes, we can. We've published a cookbook called Taste of Victory. It's a collection of recipes from the 2004 Crew Chef Challenge, and a portion of the proceeds from the book will go to Victory Junction Gang Camp.
That really is finger-licking good. Mm. And it wasn't even chicken. Oh, no,
I heard chicken.
And Benny's going to need a clean shirt after that. To those of you that felt the force and the fury of Hurricane Charlie firsthand, we want you to know you're in our thoughts and our prayers. Many members of our broadcast family have strong ties to the areas most dramatically affected, including the entire state of Florida. NASCAR is based in Daytona Beach, and of course, the Carolinas. So from our family to yours, our warmest wishes for your safety, your strength, and your success on the road to recovery. 73 points ahead of 11th place Casey Kane. Bobby's best finish in 11 races here, fifth twice. Michael Waltrip finished fourth here in 1990. He finished fourth at Sonoma in June. He starts 18th. Let's go back to the stars and the stories. Here's Marty.
Bill, what an incredible stretch for Jeff Gordon in the last six races. Three wins, no finish worse than fifth, and conventional wisdom in the garage area already has you penciled in as today's winner. Is the car as good as advertised, Jeff?
Car's good, but you can't pencil us in. We got to do a lot of work left ahead of us. I mean, there's a lot of good guys here, and we didn't really get enough practice to really know what this track's going to do today. But, I feel good about it. Our program at Sonoma was really strong. We got a good starting position. We're coming off of just an amazing week with the Brickyard, and certainly momentum's on our side, but we don't take that for granted. You know, appreciate, you know, the fact that we got to go out here and we got to compete against these guys and work hard all day long and do every aspect of what our team has to offer. You know, we got to do it all day long in the pits, on the track, everywhere, communication and everything.
For the 21st time in his career, Jeff Gordon will go for back-to-back wins. Dave?
Championship leader Jimmy Johnson has his best starting spot ever here at the Glen. I guess the question is, can you keep your teammate and everybody else behind you all day today?
I hope so. You know, I definitely feel that, you know, road course racing for me is I made some big changes and I've been stronger and stronger. Sonoma did great. I've always been strong here. Finished fourth last time, and hopefully we can improve on that. 24th flying, though. So hopefully I can lead a lap, get five in, and then go to school and learn a while and give them a hard time at the end of the day.
He has a 97-point lead over his closest pursuer now in the chase for the championship. Matt?
Dave, all eyes will be at the back of the field as road racing champion Ron Fellows will start 43rd. You have a truck win here. You've gone to victory lane in a bush car here, but how difficult to get to the front in the Cup car?
It's going to be tough, Matt. There is no question about it. But we've got, we were in that top three or four in practice, so we've got a good car here. All the DEI guys have done a terrific job for me, and I've enjoyed every minute driving this Monte Carlo. So we're gonna do what we can. We got to be a bit patient early, and then hopefully get some luck and with some cautions, and who knows?
How much more difficult is this racetrack compared to Sonoma? Is it more technical, less technical?
Well, this is the corner's a lot more high speed here. You've got a couple more opportunities to outbreak here. Turn one and the loop are the most obvious ones. The only difference is that pace tends to not fall off much here compared to Sonoma with all the up and down and cornering. So we're gonna do what we can.
He starts 43rd. If he goes to victory lane today, it'll be the deepest in the field any driver started here at Watkins Glen. The record is 18th. Steve Park, who is driving for this very team back in the year 2000, scoring his first Nextel Cup Series win, which is what this guy wants to do today. Bill?
Good point, Matt. Jeff Gordon, as you've heard, going for his sixth win of the season. Back in 1998, Jeff won 13 races and the championship. Twice he's had 10 win seasons, and he's had 2 7-win seasons. In 2001, Jeff Gordon won 6 races and the championship. That season, he got his sixth win of the season at Kansas, where he started second. Today, Jeff Gordon goes for his sixth win of the season at Watkins Glen, where he starts second. Now, you don't have to look it up because we already did. The countdown is at zero, and Nextel Cup Racing from the Glen is coming up.
This has been the Discover Card Countdown to Green. Let's go racing.
Glen, New York. Spectacular day, rain here on Friday, so the field was lined up according to the NASCAR rulebook, and that put the guys at the top of the standings at the front of the field. They have a huge advantage here today. It's the 22nd race of the Nextel Cup season, 90 laps, 220.5 miles on the twisting road course at Watkins Glen. Glad you're with us on TNT. Let's take you trackside and join the pre-race ceremonies here at the Glen.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, please remain standing for our invocation today by Chaplain Kenny Crosswhite with Motor Racing Outreach.
Father, we do pause to acknowledge your presence. We admit our dependence upon you, and we simply say thank you. Father, we ask for your provision and power for those that fight for the freedom of our country and the rights of others, for those that have recently gone through tremendous change due to this storm. Father, we also ask for your protection for those that are outside, inside, and on this track today. Father, that you would surround them with your angels. And Father, we ask that at the end of this day, you would help us to be appreciative people. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Kenny. Now, ladies and gentlemen, please remain standing for the singing of our national anthem by the lead singer, Three Doors Down, Brad Arnold.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, oh, the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave? Oh, the land of the free and the home of the brave.
Thank you.
The fans and the teams fired up. So are the drivers. Back to the grid, and Matt.
Tony Stewart has two road course victories, climbing in, hoping today to grab a third. Tony, not a lot of track practice, but you have really come into your own as a road racer, and you finished eighth Friday night.
Yeah, not too bad. We had a little bit of trouble with the flat tire that stopped us on Friday, but you know, we had a good week. The car was good in happy hour yesterday, just trying to make some changes to make it a little better, knowing that everybody else was going to make their cars a little better too.
Tony Stewart, big weekend already. His driver, Danny Lasoski, won the Knoxville Nationals last night in Iowa. Bill?
Pole sitter Jimmy Johnson has led 977 laps this season. That's more than any other driver. Will he lead the first lap today? We're about to find out. The command from NFL Hall of Famer John Riggins is next. TNT Sports presents the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series, live from Watkins Glen. Today, a twisting ride through the wine country of New York State, and the fastest guy might just be the last guy in the starting field. Now, here are three guys that first thought the road course racing started about 6:30 this morning on the way in from the hotel. At least, that's the way it looked to me. Alan Bestwick, Wally Dallenbach, and Benny Parsons.
Always ride with the 73 champion, Bill. That's my advice in that situation. You know, any NASCAR Nextel Cup Series race is hard to win. But here at Watkins Glen, the braking, the gear shifting, the uphill, the downhill, plus the strategy involved, this one's a real challenge, Wally.
It's a challenge, but it's fun. I mean, this is a fun place to come and race. I mean, you get to slide a 3,500-pound race car around all day long. And this is one of two road courses that they come to, and I think guys really enjoy it. But there is. There's a lot of strategies played out throughout the race. Last year, Rusty Wallace went off in the gravel. Robbie Gordon ducked into the pits before anybody else and got great track position. And that's what everybody's going to look at. There'll be different strategies. But this year, you have the green-white checkered, so that throws a wrench into it a little bit.
Counting today's race, five races to go until the cutoff in the Race to the Chase. BP, you think some title hopes could get some dirt thrown on them today?
Well, those chances might get broken today because of transmissions, engines, and that gravel pit we talked about. You get in those gravel pits, folks, you're going to get stuck. They got to pull you out with a wrecker. You're going to lose a lap. So don't get off the track. Stay out of the gravel pits. That's my advice.
Good advice from the former champion. Let's go trackside to get started.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome back our Grand Marshal, Pro Football Hall of Famer John Riggins, with the most famous words in racing.
Gentlemen, start your engines.
Well, a Pro Football Hall of Famer's gotten us started. We've got some sure Hall of Famers in the field today. Wonder if former Redskin Riggins' old coach's car might win. That's Tony Stewart. Racing began on the streets of the nearby village of Watkins Glen on October 2nd, 1948, until a permanent circuit was deemed necessary. Now today, the 22nd. Race for the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series happens on world-renowned Watkins Glen International. You see the cars beginning to roll off the pit lane onto the course to begin their parade and pace laps. Now, Wally came within one position of winning here, not once, but twice. He knows better than most how to go fast around the Glen. And in today's Wally's World ride around this road course, he does his best Arthur Murray imitation, making sure that you know that where the left foot and right foot are supposed to be so you don't step on anybody's toes.
Stand out, be the best for the rest. You got to know your fancy footwork. What I mean by that, the Watkins Glen, the perfect opportunity to pass is under braking. And when you go into a corner, what you're trying to do, you're trying to get your car slowed down better than the next guy. Now, there's two methods of braking. One is the heel toe, which is what I learned when I first started road racing. But then I went to the left foot braking, and that's the method I like. Gives me more control through the pedals. I can feel the car better, and I feel like I can run the car in deeper. And this is how you do it. As you're approaching the corner, put your left foot on the brake. Get on the brake, bring the R's down, flip the throttle down shift, flip the throttle down shift. Back hard on the gas. Go through the gears, again. Very smooth when you get it, when you get good at it, you really can bring a car in deep down into the corner. And that's the trick on a road course, is bringing it in deep and keeping control, not locking up the tires, not getting wheel hopped. The brake, bring the R's down, flip it, then you're back on the gas again hard. So Watkins Glen, if you're going to be a good road racer and you're going to outbrake guys, you got to be a good dancer.
You dance much better in a race car than you do in
no
the ballroom.
No question about that.
Did you notice he didn't use the clutch there, BP?
I noticed that.
Don't use the clutch.
Qualifying here at Watkins Glen was canceled by weather on Friday. Some rain during the day, and then they couldn't get some water to stop running across the track. So no Bud Pole Award winner this week. Here are the drivers qualified for next February's Budweiser Shootout at Daytona. Budweiser, the official beer of NASCAR. Proud to sponsor the Budweiser Pole Award given to the fastest qualifier at each NASCAR Nextel Cup Series race. So the field lined up according to provisions in the NASCAR rulebook, top 35 in order of owner points. So Jimmy Johnson, Jeff Gordon share the front row.
And we'll see back in row two, Dale Earnhardt Jr. and Tony Stewart. Tony won this race 2002. Last year, Jr. was third.
Matt Kenseth, Elliott Sadler in row number three. Elliott's best finish here at Watkins Glen, 15th. Of course, coming off that great Brickyard 400 run last Sunday.
Row four, Bobby Labonte has never won a road course race.
And Kurt Busch tore up his car a little bit in final practice. Talked to him this morning.
Fender repaired, and he's good to go. Ryan Newman, Kevin Harvick on the bubble in the race to the chase. 9th and 10th in points coming into the weekend.
Casey Kane, Jeremy Mayfield, teammates in row six.
And just a few points out of 10th place qualifying.
Dale Jarrett, Jamie McMurray coming from row seven. Some of the outsiders, as Weber called them earlier. Guys trying to get inside that top 10.
And another guy, Mark Martin, just cannot catch a break this year.
But gets around this place pretty good.
And he's got three wins. And Rusty Wallace, 6 road course wins. Had a birthday yesterday. He'd like to cut the cake in victory lane today. And I figure from Rusty, he will do the cake in victory lane if he wins. That's another story for later. Terry Labonte had some brake problems yesterday in practice. His crew thinks they've got those sorted out. He'll come from row 10.
Old gel changes on Greg Biffle's car this morning, including the transmission gear. And there's last year's winner, Robbie Gordon. What do you think, Wally? Can he come from there to the front?
Oh, he can do it. No question about it. Scott Wimmer, Joe Nemechek. Joe's another guy that gets around Watkins Glen really good.
Dave Blaney in his final ride for Richard Childress Racing. Jeff Burton takes over the AOL car next week at Michigan. And Ricky Rudd, 6 road course wins in Nextel competition, driving for the famed Wood Brothers from row 15 today. It's been kind of a struggling weekend for Scott Riggs.
Man, he has just struggled so much on this road course. In practice up here, he crashed a car and tore up the guardrail.
700. Nextel Cup start today for Kyle Petty. A mark few others share. We'll talk more about that later on during the race. Jeff Green and Todd Bodine. And now we get into the drivers who got into the field based on the number of qualifying attempts their car owner has made so far this season. That's what determines some of these drivers who got the final spots in the field versus some of those you'll see on the list a minute ago who were unable to qualify.
Back in outside of row 21 is Tony Ivey, his first ever NASCAR Nextel Cup start. And here's another guy that up front, he would certainly be a guy challenging for the victory.
Ron Fellows.
He's going to be fun to watch come to the 43rd starting spot. And these were the drivers, including three of the road course ringers, Klaus Groff, Scott Pruett, and Boris Said, who probably would have qualified on time, but got weathered out on Friday. Hermie Sadler, Jimmy Spencer, engine changes on their car. Pace laps take a while here at the Glen, so we'll take a break and come back for the green flag. You're watching NASCAR on TNT. Watkins Glen International in the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series, ready to go with race 22 of 2004. More importantly, just 5 to go in the race to the chase to determine who'll be in that fight for the Nextel Cup. They're on the final lap before the green flag. Let's check some final stories on pit road. We start with Dave Burns.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. had his best finishing position last year here at Watkins Glen of third after starting sixth. They think they can do better today if they'll just get a few breaks. B-R-A-K-E-S. Had problems with him at Sonoma. Talked to the crew this morning. They think they've got him fixed for Watkins Glen. Marty?
Well, Dave Elliott Sadler is sixth in the championship standings, and he told me right before the race, of all the 15 races left in the 2004 season, this is the one he's worried about the most. Goals today, very simple. Keep it on the racetrack, get a top 15 finish, not top 10, top 15, have a safe flight home because we can win the race next week at Michigan. Matt?
Marty, this could be a very good day for both Kevin Harvick and Ryan Newman, who sit 9th and 10th in the championship standings, and it really needs to be the way the Everham Red Cars have closed the gap. Harvick's never led a lap on a road course in Nextel Cup car, but he does have two top 10 finishes here. Meanwhile, Ryan Newman nearly won this race back in 2002. In fact, in 5 road course career starts, 4 top 10 finishes. Both cars look very strong for today. Bill?
Matt, some people will tell you that road course racing is a lost art. Some drivers will tell you when they come to a road course, they're simply lost. But for the guys 11th through 15th in the standings, the road to the championship clearly cuts through Watkins Glen. The machines are physically built to race this course, but the driver has to be mentally ready. To stay in the chase for the Nextel Cup, you don't have to like road course racing, but today, you better love it. Alan.
That's right. Attitude is a lot to get around this place, I think.
Half a lap away from the green flag, and if your computer's nearby your television, fire up your old AOL and go to NASCAR.com and check out Track Pass. You see the map of the Watkins Glen course. As the race gets underway, you'll be able to follow your favorite driver with NASCAR.com's pit command, the real-time telemetry, compare his time to the leaders, and so forth.
Very nice. That's exactly what this track looks like. We could get about 2,000 or 3,000 feet above it, look straight down, that's what we'd see.
It's Track Pass from NASCAR.com. Check it out at NASCAR Online. This race course, you talk to 5 different drivers, they'll give you 5 different descriptions of this course. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to call this a 7-turn course. It's a little under 2.5 miles around. The race is 90 laps. The pit window is everything today.
Yeah, everything, because exactly what Wally talked about at the very top of the show. Gambling.
Yeah, everybody's going to be looking at... See when that yellow comes out, the first yellow, and you're definitely going to have guys coming in topping off and doing that all day long, just because later on that track position is going to be worth everything.
And they figure it backwards. When they get to the window, they can make it the rest of the way. They'll be on pit road, especially if they're up front.
August 9th, 1986 was the first NASCAR, then Winston Cup race of the modern era here at Watkins Glen. They had raced here previously in 1957 and then in the mid-1960s. Now this track ringed with fans today, all on their feet waiting to see their modern day NASCAR drivers take on the famed road course, and the green flag is up, we're underway.
To funnel all those cars down into turn one, and so far a job well done.
Yeah, very clean start. Last year
Jeff Gordon got booted off the front row in that very first corner, went from the pole to 42nd on lap one. They made it this time. These are the S's. Right, left, right, uphill, high speed. Now the backstretch leading to the inner loop.
Great opportunity here to outbrake somebody going into the inner loop.
Some drivers will call it the bus stop. It's basically a chicane. And now the carousel corner.
Oh, goodness, how long will that camera will not be there long, I don't believe.
Right one. Off the carousel, a long sweeping right-hander. Now down the third and final straightaway to corners 6 and 7.
And Jimmy Johnson, the 40 car, he wants to get back to the start-finish line. He wants to lead this first lap, get those 5 bonus points. After that, as he said, he's going to settle in and go to school. Watch the master, Jeff Gordon.
Mission accomplished. 5 bonus points toward the championship for Johnson, and here comes Jeff Gordon. New leader, and a bit for second as Tony Stewart goes to work on Jimmy Johnson. Go ahead, Bill.
Well, that car Jeff Gordon is driving is the same one he took to victory lane here in at Sonoma. They raced it here a year ago. They did make a transmission and a drive shaft change after their practice session yesterday because of a vibration. Him starting on the front row is like giving Tiger Woods 10 strokes and trying to beat him. Dave?
Bill, it's already been mentioned how important it was for Jimmy Johnson to lead that lap. 5 bonus points for leading a lap in Nextel Cup competition. He got that. But also, he's never led in a road course before. That's another important feather in his cap. And they radioed to him, okay, now settle in, get your rhythm, and after he got past, follow those guys.
Here we go, Tony Stewart. He's trying to deny Jeff Gordon those 5 bonus points. A great move by Tony Stewart to take the lead.
That was a great move.
Jeff Gordon did not lead at the start-finish line last lap. He will not this lap. Tony Stewart, the 2002 winner, leads lap 2. Single file through the first 6. Single file back to about the first 15 or 18. They sort it out in the opening laps. See Mark Martin there running in 15th coming through. There's Robbie Gordon running in 20th. Ron Fellows will come into the view here in just a second. He's already picked up about 10 spots in the opening lap and a half. There's Fellows in the one, Bill.
And he told me this morning, Alan, that the most critical lap for him in this race was the first lap. He just wanted to make sure he could get through the first turn and through the chicane on the backstretch. Then, patiently, and he underscored patiently, pick off cars one at a time. He wants to be 15th by lap 30. Then the race for Fellows will really begin.
Well, he's 33rd now after starting 43rd.
And that's what exactly he's doing. He's just picking these cars off 2 or 3 times a lap. Every time he gets into a braking zone, he's picking them off. Here he goes by Ricky Craven.
Ron Fellows, one of the drivers for the factory Corvette team in the American Le Mans Series and in the 24 Hours of Le Mans road race overseas, that famous event. He is 4-for-6 this season in wins on that series. And we got one with some fender damage. It's Jimmy Spencer.
They changed. Looks like he's got an engine problem, and they changed engines in that car this morning. And looks like something is going to miss with that one. I thought I saw fire under the bottom of that car.
Yeah, he's got some damage on the right side, right rear of the car. It looks like it's crashed.
To the garage. Check out what might have happened to Jimmy Spencer to put him behind the wall in the opening laps.
That's in a carousel.
When he blows up, somebody's going right in the back of him.
Yeah, that's what happened. Kyle Petty.
So Spencer not known for his enjoyment level of racing.
No, he's very happy right now.
Well, Scott Wimmer's got troubles. 22 car. Lost power.
Looks like the car's back up to speed now. Looks like he got the car in neutral or something, and can imagine what happened.
I'll bet we can find out.
We have cameras every place.
Got.
Oh, there we go.
Spun around, getting into the inner loop.
So those two words we're going to hear a lot today when things happen, probably played there. Wheel hop.
Yeah. Wheel hop could have done it, or too much rear brake.
You want to clue some folks in on what wheel hop might be?
The best way to explain wheel hop normally, it can happen two ways. You can either have too much front brake where the brakes just grab too good and it dives, the front of the car noses down and the rear gets light, or you have too much rear brake. What happens is when you get down the corner, it's just like having 2 pogo sticks in the rear for shocks. The car just starts bouncing. And when it starts bouncing and you're trying to slow the car down, it's pretty terrifying.
And it makes an awfully uncomfortable sound when you hear those back tires chattering.
Hey, Dave, how about the 20 car? What's they saying about Tony Stewart?
You know, BP, a couple things that Matt alluded to when he talked to Tony early on, I want to get back to. 2 things that make Tony very excited about competing in his Nextel Cup car. 1 is competing. The second one is competing on here Friday night at Watkins Glen. He ran a sports car to an 8th-place finish in the dark here with the lights of the sports car. It was a pretty good race for him, although he had a flat tire putting him back to 8th. And then last night, as he mentioned, his driver in the World of Outlaws series.
Goodbye, Dave.
See you, Dave.
The tech team to Dave Burns, please. I'll finish the thought, though. Tony Stewart's team that he owns in the World of Outlaws series, Danny Lasoski, won their version of the Daytona 500 last night, the Knoxville Nationals. Fourth time that the dude has won the race. Congratulations to him. Let's see if we can hear Matt through his whole report. What do you say, Matt?
The fourth car in line, the Budweiser Chevy, Dale Earnhardt Jr. In fact, he and Tony Stewart nearly won the 24 hours of Daytona. Came within 20.
Bye, Matt. Bye, Matt.
Looks like it's just us, guys.
Okay, we'll send the pit boys in for pit stop, and we'll take a break. Tony Stewart is the second leader.
Oh, wait a minute.
There's the gravel traps. Dale Jarrett, one of the outsiders, trying to get into the top 10.
That's not what he needed.
Oh, man, exactly what we said could not happen, getting stuck in the gravel trap.
And he is hub deep. Look at the back tire spinning. Look at the right rear tire just spinning, trying to get out.
He's on the gas, but the bottom of the car is wedged up against the gravel.
Inner loop.
Bus stop, whatever you want to call it.
And frustrated.
And he'll lose a lap, man. At least a lap. See if we can
Brian Vickers,
see what happens
the other
here.
Driver.
Give him a check. Wow. Vickers just hit that curve, hit it the wrong way, and he went flying into the 88 car, Dale Jarrett. Dale Jarrett was in the wrong place at the wrong time.
And you saw Dale just before we went to the replay waving with his hand inside the car. Push me out, please.
But they can't. It's going to take a record to get him out.
Well, we figured we'd see this storyline today. We just didn't necessarily know it would be only five laps into the race. But Dale Jarrett, the 13th place driver in the championship, 55 points out of 10th starting the day, stuck.
Oh, man. And once again, Brian Vickers is bringing the wrath of a veteran driver down on top of him. This is 3 weeks in a row.
Now, does 88 become the lucky dog?
There are no lucky dogs on a road course.
That's right.
They don't use that rule at the road courses. So once you go a lap down, it's almost impossible to get it back. And the other thing is, they only allow single-file restarts on the road course, so you can't even double up if you're the lap car. You get a lap down here, you got problems.
Yeah, you've got a long way to go.
And here comes the field behind the pace truck to where Dale Jarrett's car still sits. And you are about to see him be put a lap down. They'll skip the inner loop so the rescue workers can do their thing there.
Yeah, just skipping on, let them go.
And a lap down for Dale Jarrett and Brian Vickers.
And DJ had a big week coming up. He was going to look forward. He's a co-chairman of the Greater Hickory Classic this week, the seniors golf tournament in Hickory, and big week, and guess what? I'll probably beat him this week. Well, we won't go left.
So, early troubles for one of the drivers in the race to the chase.
That man, man.
Gotta make him mad, especially since it wasn't your fault. Somebody else did it.
I can't see anybody pitting here. Can you, BP?
No.
Maybe some of the guys in the back of the field to top off the fuel, like Wally said, but I can't see any of the leaders stopping here.
No.
Too early.
Yeah. Too early.
So let's take our break here. We'll come back and recap anyone who does stop, figure out where Dale Jarrett and Brian Vickers end up. But Jarrett, the first victim of the gravel trap at the inner loop here at Watkins Glen.
Gentlemen, start your engines.
NASCAR on TNT comes to you from Watkins Glen. I got a lap ahead of myself. Pace car out in front of the field, and cleanup work continues out in the inner loop. Congratulations to Bobby Hamilton. Picked up a win in Nashville, his hometown, last night in the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series. Kind of emotional in victory lane. Glad to see a well-deserved victory. Championship standings in the trucks. Hamilton extending his lead as Dennis Setzer had some late troubles in the race after 15 of 25 events. Bobby looking good for the championship for now. NASCAR Busch Series, no race this weekend. You see the championship standings after their event 1 week ago at Indianapolis Raceway Park. They race next at Michigan International Speedway next Saturday. You'll see it here on TNT.
You saw Carl Edwards, the fourth place runner in the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series. He will be driving the 99 car
that Jeff Burton is driving today, next week at Michigan, and I'm told the rest of the year, trying to get him some experience. And there we see DJ is out of the gravel trap.
But he's a lap down and in 40th place and at the end of the line.
And really mad.
And he was only 55 points out of the top 10.
Now it's 146. So
man,
he lost almost 100 points in that little trip into the trap.
All it takes is one bad one.
One bad one.
One bad one will take you out.
Here are the guys that pitted. First one was 29th place Ricky Craven. Todd Bodine came in. Jeff Green, Kyle Petty, Scott Riggs, Scott Wimmer, Ken Schrader, Jarrett and Vickers, then Morgan Shepherd, Tony Ave, and Hermie Sadler. None of the leaders came down pit road.
We'll see a lot of guys popping out here, BP, trying to make that braking pass down into turn one. It's a favorite time to do it on a restart.
They can't pass till they get to the start-finish line. All right, now they're starting diving out.
Jimmy Junior. Johnson didn't get a very good restart. Look at this.
Junior going for third. Kyle Busch.
Ooh.
Oh, baby.
It gets real exciting down there on a restart.
Whoa, Elliott Sadler with a little bobble off the curbs. He and Matt Kenseth almost got together right there, 38-17.
Seth, give it to 17. Elliott did not want to be on the outside down in turn two, the beginning of the S's.
And he's already lost a lot of momentum being there as he's going to get passed here by Bobby Labonte.
Robbie Gordon, keep an eye on that orange nose, a little bit back in traffic too. He's coming toward the front.
Jamie McMurray and Ryan Newman go through the inner loop together. Wow.
Heard Robbie Gordon say on Discover Card Countdown to Green, those fenders are important here at Watkins Glen. High-speed racetrack, downforce needed.
Not only that, but you don't want to crush the front of your car. Wow, that's close right
wow,
there.
That was close.
Because you've got all those openings for the very important brakes.
Oh, look out.
Oh, Robbie Gordon is wanting to get to the front, but he's got to be very careful.
And Michael Walsh wanting to keep Robbie Gordon behind him. This is from the front bumper.
That was a great shot.
Of Robbie Gordon's singular Chevy.
That is cool.
Check out the charge to turn one on the restart a lap ago.
Junior driving to the inside of Jimmy Johnson. Takes a spot away. Saw Tony Stewart smoking the left front tire on the under braking. And check Labonte and Ryan Newman and Harvick. And I guess that was a 17 of Matt Kenseth.
Yep. Kurt Busch with a nice slide to pick up a couple of spots there.
Hey, Matt. Junior looks to be a little aggressive right now in the A car.
BP, he led 11 laps here last year. He wants a road course victory on his Nextel Cup racing resume. Has a Busch win here, but the car earlier in the race was tight. He said pretty much everywhere, but now it has neutralized, and he's trying to make his way to the front.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. had a great run here at Watkins Glen a year ago, and he said that kind of proved, he finished third, he said that kind of proved his team had arrived as contenders on a road course. They hadn't enjoyed a lot of success in the Cup Series here before. He won a Busch Series race back in 98, but he said we arrived last year with that big, with that top five run.
I was impressed last year with what Junior did on the road courses, Lawrenceville. He really worked at being a complete race car driver in 2003.
There's a lot of teams that, you know, all these guys get around this road course really well now. They put a lot of emphasis on this race. I mean, it just pays the same amount of points as any other race. So you have to get good at it. You can't use this race as a throwaway. Very important.
And I think it's one of the great things about the championship. You have to be a good driver on a lot of different types of tracks to be the Nextel Cup Series champ. The Daytona drafting, the Martinsville short tracking, here at Watkins Glen on the road course, the big fast tracks like California or Charlotte or some of those places. You gotta have it together in a lot of different disciplines.
And next week at Michigan, how the drivers will be searching for that new line around the racetrack to try to find some grip. It will be fantastic.
Jimmy Johnson back to fourth place, Dave.
Yeah, he got passed on that last restart, Alan, and he's not trusting his braking system right now. They changed it this morning. They had on there a system, a package, if you will, that they used at Sonoma this year. And Jimmy told me while we were riding around during driver introductions that they needed to change that because it was too aggressive. It was good for the short Sonoma track where you only have to pounce on them about one time. Here, there's so many high-speed braking zones. They said they needed to go different, and he still doesn't trust the way it's feeling right now. Bill?
Dave, 24 car of Jeff Gordon. According to the driver, the car's just a little bit loose right now, but in his words, we'll be all right. So leading, not important to him right now, but the car perhaps getting better as the laps go by.
So he may not be feeling like Superman right now, but he thinks he can be by the end of the race. Watching back through, there's Jamie McMurray, 42, coming through, and Robbie Gordon, up to 13th.
Matt, what are they saying about Robbie's car? He's making a move.
He was the Superman on the road courses last year, sweeping both races, trying to make his way to the front as well. Up to 13th, working on Michael Waltrip. Same race car he ran at Sonoma and the Glen last year, winning both. He says right now on the radio, the car is good. Not a whole lot of conversation, Wally. You know, as a driver, not a lot of conversation. That's good news for his team.
Michael Waltrip, best finish here at Watkins Glen, fourth in 1990. Kevin Harvick trying to hang on to his spot in the top 10. He's eighth right now. As we come back to Watkins Glen, Jeff Gordon has taken the lead away from Tony Stewart. The all-time leading road course winner in NASCAR Racing's back out in front.
One of those spots you were talking about, Wally.
Beautiful outbreaking job.
Down in turn one. Tony knew it was coming.
Yeah, he did.
So Jeff Gordon, the third different driver to lead the race, and evens up the bonus point tally with his teammate Jimmy Johnson. As far as those five extra points that go for leading a lap in Nextel Cup competition. Now, fourth place has changed hands. Kurt Busch has passed Jimmy Johnson, who's falling back into the clutches of Matt Kenseth and Bobby Labonte. Now, Dave, something up there?
Two laps ago, the championship leader radioed in and said, this transmission is coming apart. His crew snapped two. They went after a new transmission just in case, but he stayed on the track. And one lap ago, his crew chief, Chad Knaus, radioed to him, tell me about it when you can. Jimmy radioed back and said, everything's fine now.
Oh. They don't fix themselves, so.
He's a rubber or something bounce up and make it balky or then go away. Who knows?
I guess he just couldn't not get the car in gear.
So we'll keep an eye out on the championship leader, Jimmy Johnson. How about our singular wireless race talk poll? Trouble. We'll get back to it. Sterling Marlin, that's just exiting turn one. Caution is out, full course yellow, and the field is frozen.
Just looking over at our...
All right, all clear.
Wow. I hear Greg Biffle has gotten a piece of Sterling Marlin.
That was 22nd, 23rd. Last time they went by.
And so yellow flag number one is out here at Watkins Glen. Let's check it out.
Trying to outbreak him, and hard to see that angle, but
yeah,
that was pretty obvious there.
Wow. That's heavy contact with that right front. Board with Greg Biffle as he goes down the corner trying to get on the inside. Sterling gives him room, but just pushes up and catches that right rear.
First angle again. I think he hit that curb with the right side tires, Biffle did, and it might have jumped him to the left just a little bit. But for now, Sterling Marlin has a mess.
A wrecked race car.
On his hands, and he's no longer running 22nd. Watch Biffle's right side wheels and the curbing on the right as he goes into the corner, driver's right. See if that doesn't move him over a little bit.
That could be.
Yeah, little bit, but not that much.
Not a lot, no. Okay. So we're under caution here at Watkins Glen International for this incident in turn one between Greg Biffle and Sterling Marlin. We'll see who comes down pit road. We expect most of the leaders when we come back in a minute. You're watching NASCAR on TNT. Good afternoon here in Watkins Glen, New York, in the Finger Lakes region of the Empire State. Pit road is closed because Sterling Marlin's car sits at the pit exit. The safety workers are still there, so no leaders coming in to make pit stops here. We were starting to talk about our singular wireless race talk poll when the incident happened a moment ago. During Discover Card Countdown to Green, we talked about a lot of the safety innovations that have come along in the last 12 months in NASCAR racing. We want to know what you think has been the most important of those safety advancements. The safer barriers, softer walls, if you will, no racing back to the caution, the escape hatch in the roof, or some of the fire safety apparatus that's now on board the cars in the trunk and the driver's cockpit and so on.
Can I ask the fans to please vote the way I would?
No.
Come on, I
know what you're thinking. Please. Come back.
Please.
There's how you vote. We'll see if you agree with BP a little bit later on. Pit stops from the leaders expected when we come back. Right now, the pit lane is closed. The pace truck is out in front of the field here at Watkins Glen. It's the campers, the fans, and the grandstands lining both sides of this famed Watkins Glen road course as the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series races today for the 22nd time here. And we're under caution for the second time in the race after Sterling Marlin and Greg Biffle got together in turn one. Pit road is open as the field comes to the final corner.
You know, I guess they all got to make a pit stop, but really it doesn't gain you anything. You still got to stop twice from here.
Let's see. Leader says no. Second says
Junior.
No. Junior's in. Jimmy Johnson's in. Kenseth doesn't make the commitment line. Harvick says yes. Sadler says no.
Man, oh man.
But everything. Go ahead, Matt.
Seven laps ahead of what they had scheduled for their first pit stop. They're going to make a track bar adjustment. The car was a little too free in some areas. This could really shake things up if we get a green-white checkered finish today.
Ron Fellows from 43rd to 18th. He's going to give all that up. Pitting the cars a little tight. They want to free him up on the left-handers. He's good in the S's. They're making a change that they made yesterday in practice, but this is a very, very long stop. Burns.
The 48 car of Jimmy Johnson will change four tires air out of the rears for better grip. They cannot do anything to the transmission. He doesn't have first gear. He pushes it off in second. It looks off pit road.
Well, that's going to be big the rest of the day trying to get off pit road, especially if they were to make a green flag stop.
Right. That's right.
So Jimmy Johnson had no first gear. Casey Kane heading out, Marty.
That was a rough stop for Casey Kane's guys. The car's actually pretty good. They are tied in turn two. Otherwise, pretty good. They made an air pressure adjustment trying to fix it. Bad problem was he got blocked in on pit road. Had to lose 10, 15 spots, Alan.
I want to get Matt Yoakum to check on Robbie Gordon also. Think he might have just gotten a couple of tires on that pit stop. We'll set the strategy for you when we come back to Watkins Glen.
To get away from rear wheel hop, is they're using different manufacturers, front and rear. We saw AP racing on Mark Marsh's car. He may have another manufacturer on the rear. He may have AP, but some of the guys, AP on the front, another manufacturer right on the rear.
They're looking for that balance to see what works. And sometimes the brakes are too aggressive. You put, like you say, APs on the front, and they're so aggressive, you got to put Brembos on the back or something to find that balance. Yeah.
Well, when I first started driving these cars on a road course, those things were a quarter of the size.
Oh, I know.
And we
huge.
Just saw them. And they didn't stop these cars.
You know, brakes used to be about $2,000 for the car. Now they're what, $10,000 for a car or something. All right, here we go.
Jeff Gordon leads. Tony Stewart is second. Kurt Busch third. Matt Kenseth fourth. Bobby Labonte fifth. None of those drivers pitted under this caution. That means we'll see them on pit road under the green fairly shortly.
Here you see guys flaring out. Mark. Whoa, that was interesting. Jamie McMurray went to the outside of the 38 car of Elliott Sadler, but couldn't pull it off.
And now has to fend off Mark Martin. First driver off pit lane on the stops, Robbie Gordon. He's in 13th place. Let's also mention that Casey Mears pitted under the green just before the yellow. So he stayed on track under the caution, passed all those guys. He's running 14th. Robbie Gordon got him on the restart. Dale Jr.'s 15th, and then all the other guys farther on down who stopped. How about Robbie Gordon? What are you doing his pit stop, Matt?
Going for track position, took left side tires only, knowing some other drivers were going to pit. They want to try to beat those guys out. Robbie said the car was very strong. It is just so difficult to pass here.
Well, that'd be interesting to see how this car reacts with changing just left side tires on road course.
and I don't see where this pit stop got them anything. They've still, I think the fellas that stopped have still got to stop twice again, and the leaders are only going to stop twice.
Here's the trick to the strategy and the rub to the strategy these days. First of all, the big picture on strategy is start at 90 laps, which is the distance today. Take your fuel mileage number and count backwards. You want to stop as soon as you can and stay on track longer later in the race. With the gravel traps out here, a lot of crew chiefs I talked with this morning, Benny and Wally, were talking about how many laps of yellow do you want to gamble on there being to see if you can stop before the next guy.
And you have to count, at least give yourself a couple laps for a green white checker.
Right. And that's what they're all thinking about.
Bill's got Sterling Marlin with him back in the garage.
The crew working on the car, your version of what happened out there, Sterling.
I got run over by a bug-eyed dummy, I guess. It was just patient still here and just drove in there. Mile over his head like I done Gordon last year and took us out. Just hated it. Took all the guys on the Coors Light team. Just was there making laps then and can't win for losing. I tell you, it's something all the time.
Well, that's a quote that'll make the papers.
Yeah, and I feel Sterling is right there. That could have been avoided. Biffle could have cracked the throttle and give Sterling a break on that deal and not turn him into the guardrail.
But Sterling's in the garage getting repairs, being shown back in 40th place now. And Greg Biffle continues on in the race.
Robbie Gordon's able to get by Terry Labonte, move up another spot.
Robbie's up to 12th. Here comes Casey Mears trying Terry.
There. Wow, he's going to pull it off. A couple guys going to get by Terry.
Junior, Kevin Harvick.
Don't want to be on the outside going to that corner.
I like that. Waltrip.
But I think Terry must have some problems. He lost a lot of ground there.
Had some brake problems in final practice yesterday, if you remember, so maybe they didn't get it all fixed. Looking for Ryan Newman, 10th place driver in the championship, all the way back to 30th, Dave.
Had problems with their brakes yesterday, and they made big changes overnight. Did that fix their problems? Listen.
I'm really, really giving up a ton, and it ain't going to get any better. It's actually gotten worse as I've gone here. I'm at the edge here as far as stopping, and I'm having to bump them down every straightaway.
The problem is I don't think we're going to fix this by bleeding in the front. We've led them three times this morning, and it's, you know what I mean, it's not fixing that issue.
They changed calipers, rotors, pads, even manufacturers, so they had to change all the brake ducts as well. Obviously, it has not helped. They spent a long time on pit road during this caution and were one of the last ones off pit road, hoping that they bled the air out of those brake lines.
Yeah, that's something that's not going to get better. When you're pumping your brakes on a road course, it's just going to get worse and worse.
So with Dale Jarrett having problems and Ryan Newman deep in the field, there is what the race to the chase looks like now.
Mayfield is in.
Right now, 4 points ahead of Ryan Newman, and Casey Kane just 11 points behind his teammate, Jeremy Mayfield.
He's still got gravel traps lurking around him for 67 more laps at Watkins Glen.
Yeah, I don't know what they can do to fix that problem, BP. That's just something that, unfortunately, Ryan's going to have to live with. There's nothing really you can do about that.
Well, obviously, as long as they stayed in the pits, they did try to bleed the air out of them, and once you get air in these brakes, then they won't work properly. It takes all fluid, all hydraulic fluid, and no air. They tried to bleed the system. Evidently, Ryan is still struggling with that.
And the race for the lead, Tony Stewart is chasing Jeff Gordon, but something's possibly up with Tony, we hear, Dave.
And it is literally up with Tony. He's got stomach cramps going on right now. He wants to get out of that race car, hates to even think about it, running second. They're looking for one of the road course drivers that may not have gone home yet, specifically right now, Scott Pruitt. Scott, if you're out there, you might want to report to the 20 pit because they would like to put you in the car.
Dave, I'm on my way.
Come back here, Wally, come back here.
And they did not mention Wally.
His eyes shot up in a heartbeat. Well, he's running second. Hard to get out of a race car performing that well.
Yeah.
He must really be feeling unpleasant. Matt?
No changes for Terry Labonte Chevrolet. He is, though, experiencing brake problems, similar problems the team was experiencing in final practice on Saturday. The pedal just gets weaker and weaker, and they're going with their original strategy. That's why they pitted under green. And Wally, one thing to keep in mind, Mark Cronquist, to further add on Dave's story, is going up and down pit road to every single pit, even stopped in Dale Jr.'s pit looking for Scott Pruitt.
Tony poked the nose out from behind Jeff Gordon with a bid for the lead, but wasn't able to pull it off in turn six. Now they head down to turn one. Here he comes again.
And Boris said may be here, but I don't think Boris is taller than
him. Jeffrey. Jeff Gordon got a little bit and slid the car under braking there, and that's what cost him that spot.
I don't think as tall as Boris said is, he could fit inside Tony Stewart's car.
That's going to be the other problem, is getting somebody that can fit in there properly.
I was thinking about you because you're almost the same size as Tony Stewart.
Don't keep tempting him with that, BB. He will put the headset down and run for a minute. So Tony Stewart back out in front. Now Kurt Busch working on Jeff Gordon for second.
Uh-oh, this is unscheduled.
Yes, it is, because he was just on pit road under the caution a minute ago.
Is he turning in?
Guys,
I think he's going to turn in the garage, because all the boys are leaving from the pit stall here. Going to go work on that car in the garage. It might be engine because of the transmission problems they've been having, and it might be transmission, but it's not good for the championship leader.
Did he just say it's terminal? Or Jimmy Johnson?
That's 2 weeks in a row for the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series championship leader. Remember, Jimmy Johnson out at Indianapolis with an engine failure, and now here at Watkins Glen, he could potentially finish 40th in this race.
These DuPont guys need to get back to their pits, because it looks like that Jeff Gordon may be having some kind of problem.
Comes Kurt Busch into the picture.
Yeah.
Jimmy Johnson would give up the championship lead if he falls out of the race here and Jeff Gordon is able to finish.
But what a great time to have trouble. I mean, if you got to have trouble in a season right now,
this
Jimmy
is the season to have trouble.
This is the time to have it. That's right.
Here's what Jimmy Johnson said just a minute ago.
That's terminal. Won't even turn over.
Engine.
Dave, you got more?
Well, just that Jimmy is very disappointed with this, obviously, but it's because he was so much better after using Jeff Gordon's setup on this road course. He'd been running his own setup up until this race, a softer front end, and he finally went over to Jeff's side saying, you know, if Jeff's that good, I've got to try it. And he was happy about where it was going. Bill?
Dave, that 24 car of Jeff Gordon just will not get in the go coming off those right-handers. He's really frustrated that the car just will not go when he comes off the right-hand turns. They're going to try and fix that about a lap or two away from pitting.
But Bill, are they saying why it's not going? Is it an engine thing? Or
Wally, he said that he has plenty of brakes. The car is just not stopping the way he wants it to. And then just a lap ago, he said the car just will not go on the right-handers.
Elliott Sadler comes down pit road. Scheduled green flag stop, Matt.
Very solid run going for Elliott Sadler. He says the car is very much to his liking. You can see a chassis adjustment made on the 38 car. It was a little tight on the right-handers earlier, and an air pressure adjustment for the 38 car. Oh, and he stalls the car. Finally refires. He's down and away.
So Elliott Sadler, who had a terrific race at Indianapolis in the Brickyard 400 last Sunday with a third-place finish, never run better than 15th here at Watkins Glen, and he's back on track after a green flag stop.
But you see, he's going to be back on the racetrack in front of the leaders. And now he hopes that a caution flag would come out, they would all pit, leave him on the racetrack in front of them.
Matt Kenseth running fourth, Bobby Labonte fifth, Jamie McMurray sixth. Here's McMurray trying Labonte for a spot. Wendy's race menu next Sunday. 2 miles, high speed, Michigan. Be a lot of fun. And then it's out of the night race at Bristol.
The direct opposite of exactly what he said about Michigan.
Yeah.
Short track, full ring.
But it'll still be fun.
It will. Labor Day weekend, the California Speedway, the day into night race there. And then the race to the chase ends at Richmond. And we find out who makes that top 10 and contends for the title over the season's final 10 races. Our Wendy's race menu. It's the best race among the top 10 at this point. Kenseth
Labonte McMurray for his fourth, fifth, and sixth. And you see three-time Watkins Glen winner Mark Martin moving into the picture up from his 15th starting spot. Mark did not pit under the caution. We expect we'll see him on pit road sometime soon.
We'll see these guys fairly soon, because one thing you do not want to do here is run out of fuel. If you do, if you're by the start-finish line, you will not coast back.
And here comes Kurt Busch, Matt Kenseth, and Mark Martin onto pit road. Let's check with Bill in the garage.
Alan, Jimmy Johnson wanted to talk it over with car owner Rick Hendrick before he talked to the media. His car is back here, the crew looking at it, but you can just see the disgust on his face. Talking it over now with his crew chief, Chad Canales, had a long conversation with car owner Rick Hendrick. You can see Chad with a smile, and they won't talk about this after noon tomorrow. That's when Chad says all the bad stuff's behind us, Matt.
A 97-17 leaves with a lot of smoke. No adjustments. Meanwhile, the 97 Busch, they made a chassis adjustment. The car starts out tight and ends up loose. Marty?
Matt, the Roush car is pitting together. Mark Martin from 7th said, I'm not as good on the straightaways as I would like. Car handling pretty good, though. A pound out of both rear tires. A little bit loose off for Mike Martin trying to tighten up that car.
Like Kurt Busch kind of had a long stop there. Had some troubles on the right side. And it cost him a spot. Matt Kenseth went around him.
And we saw those cars as soon as they got off pit road by that last line where pit road speed limit is, what, 35 miles per hour today. We heard them accelerate. Here comes the leader on pit road.
Tony Stewart's in. Jeff Gordon follows him in. This would be as the race is a lap shy of its 1/3 point. Bill?
In their window, the car's a little loose. Want to make a track bar adjustment. Also talk about making an air pressure adjustment. Gordon has talked about not happy with the way the car is performs under braking, but he says the brakes feel fine. It's just the way the car is handling. He's got a good pit stall, easy out, we go to Dave.
Tony Stewart stays in the car. They will try to hand something through the window to help settle his stomach. They'll make a four tire change and a chassis adjustment. He's just a little bit loose on the racetrack, and he's going to gut it out. Marty.
Dave Rusty Wallace running in fifth. The main thing he wanted on this pit stop was the tear off pulled away. He had a lot of fluid on the tear off. Four tires, no changes for the two car.
Yeah, and folks, that is Rusty Wallace. Trust us. Oh, Bobby Labonte pulls out right in front of him. He decided, they told Kodak that they were trying to do something special for them at this racetrack, which is very close to the headquarters of Kodak, where Rochester, I think, is headquarters for Eastman Kodak.
Yep, just about 75 miles or so from here. And Kodak, the primary sponsor of Rusty's teammate, Brendan Gaughan's car. New leader, Robbie Gordon, did stop under the caution, took just the left side tires. Casey Mears stopped under the green, stayed out when the caution flew, so he'll move up to the number two spot. Then you'll get back to Dale Jr., the first one off the pit stops before under the yellow with four fresh tires. He'll move up to third, Kevin Harvick fourth, Joe Nemechek fifth. Let's ride with Robbie.
Pretty busy right through here, up through the S's. Grab fourth gear right down here. Wow, he's really running that thing out. Woo-hoo! Turn that motor.
The motor said, please shift me.
Second gear, flying into the inner loop.
Really got a tiptoe through here.
Wally, does it look like he's out for a little Sunday afternoon drive?
Yeah.
That's exactly what he says. The car feels absolutely great. I feel like I'm just cruising.
Pumping the brakes.
Yeah, we talked about pumping the brakes. You saw his left foot as he got down to that corner, just pumping, trying to get a brake pedal. Watch him again.
Yep, and that, like BP says, you're trying to get a brake pedal. It's also a security pump. Make sure those things are there.
And the kitty litter, Herman
Sattler. Stand on the gas.
Buried it.
Caution's out. That is in turn one. And we'll bring out the yellow flag for a third time in the race. And the pace truck already has picked up leader Robbie Gordon. So cycle of pit stops complete. We'll figure out where Jeff Gordon and the rest of them are running in just a moment. Robbie Gordon, the new leader here at Watkins Glen. Big story on the day so far. The championship leader, Jimmy Johnson,
is in the garage area. Robbie Gordon won here at Watkins Glen a year ago. He's trying to make it two straight on this most famous road course. Under caution here at Watkins Glen, most of the lead drivers have stayed out on track. Some of those a little farther back in the pack are coming onto the pit lane. Let's show you why we're under the yellow flag. Hermie Sadler heading downhill towards turn one.
And a good reason why you have the gravel or something down there.
Looks like he just lost his brakes.
He goes to the corner and the car just doesn't slow down. There is some smoke from the tires, but it looked like it might have been a rear tire or something that locked up. He tries to drive it through. Yes, if that gravel hadn't been there, he'd have run into the outside retaining wall pretty hard. Right front locks up.
It looks like he's got too much front brake and not enough rear brake.
So stuck in the gravel trap, bringing out the caution, none of the leaders pit. We'll take a break. You're watching NASCAR on TNT. Watkins Glen, cleanup continuing as we work the third caution flag of today's race after Hermie Sadler got stuck in the gravel trap down in turn one. His brother Elliott Sadler's team picked up $20,000 at Indianapolis.
Hey, guys, good job.
The gravity-defying a Chocolate Thunder pit crew, as they name themselves. They win the McDonald's Drive-Thru Pit Crew Championship, fueled by Powerade for the Brickyard 400 by spending the least amount of time on pit road among eligible teams. 5 points separating Sadler and Dale Jr.'s team for the season-long $200,000 starting today. Well, a relief driver has been found.
A real tall one.
A very tall one. How much do you think? 5 or 6 inches taller than Tony Stewart?
That's going to be a...
at least.
That's going to be crowded.
Boris said, talking with team's crew chief Greg Zipidelli there, Dave.
The discussion is between crew chief Greg Zipidelli, as you said, and Boris said. Boris has already been in the backup car in the garage. The fit, according to Zipidelli, was a little tight. That was radioed to Tony Stewart. Obviously, Boris a lot taller than Tony. Tony did come back a little later and say, did you say Boris could fit? I think Tony wants to get out of the car based on the tone of his voice, but he said he would gut it out. Zippy told him they needed to do it under caution if they were going to do it and get it over with. So that's the discussion now between Boris and Greg. We'll try to find out if they decide yes or no on a driver change.
Okay.
Well, it killed track position, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Well, you got to do it sooner than later to try and get some of that track position back in the late laps. Got some gravel to sweep off the track, so that's why we're still under the yellow. Watkins Glen as the green flag waits for the restart. Robbie Gordon is the leader, and they quickly fan out on the Watkins Glen front stretch.
Wally, they better start falling down. They will not fit
for the
line.
No.
Oh, yeah. Somehow, some way, they all made it.
Wally, watch this first lap of the restart. The championship leaders in the garage with Bill.
Jimmy, very difficult day. First of all, tell me about the motor.
Yeah, the motor was fine. I made a mistake on a restart. We were trying to do shifter and transmission, and I didn't have any problems with it in practice or anything, and I just made an error myself today, going from second to third, and caught it into first on a restart, and ended up hurting first gear in the transmission, and then with that over rev, it hurt the engine, and I lost first gear and was able to still stay up to speed, and using second and on and was fine, but when we went back to the restart, I hurt something in the engine and ended up taking us out.
2 weeks in a row, a lot of points have been spent.
Yeah, it has. I've probably been the slowest to conform with this new point system, but right now, it's helping us out. It's still a lot of racing left either way. It doesn't matter the point system, but just too bad. And, today was all my fault. I feel terrible for these slowest guys, for Engine Motorsports, knocking myself out of this. And I swore I was just out there cruising around, having fun, and made a small mistake that was very costly.
Does the 24 have that same transmission, Jimmy?
Yep, they've got the same thing. And, hopefully Jeff is crisp and precise with the shifts and doesn't have any problems. And the transmission's great. It's something different, and I made a mistake, so I'm not trying to blame anybody. The transmission guys have worked very hard with it to make it right, and just messed up.
Thanks for stopping. We'll see you next week.
Yeah, thanks.
And Alan, they warned Jeff Gordon about shifting from second to third. They explained to him what happened to the 48 and warned him to help prevent him from doing it.
I'm pretty sure that's that new transmission that takes pilots make with a shifter that moves over to the center of the transmission. And when the new car that Dave Byrne showed you in their pre-race today, when they moved the driver, when they got to move the shifter over. So that's and the throws on that transmission are very, very close. Oh, we see Harvick going for the lead.
And getting it and getting it.
Turn six. Thank you, Robbie. Did a wave to the teammates. So Kevin Harvick's out in front, Matt.
Richard Childress came on Robbie Gordon's radio and said the 29 would love it if you'd let them jump out, lead a lap, and then we'll let you overtake the 29 and retake that lead. Thinking about points, trying to solidify that 29 car in the top 10 and it's after Richmond. Have a shot at that title.
How about that? Yeah. 5 points, and that could be big.
Now, though, it might cost Kevin a couple spots on track. Here comes Casey Mears in the 41, and Dale Jr. lurks behind.
Nice move, Casey made.
It was a nice move.
Here comes Junior.
Yep. You got to get on the brakes hard and let it roll just a little bit further, but couldn't do it. Harvick drove in there hard.
And Nemechek, that 01 car, right there as well. Hey, guys, how's Tony Stewart? What's he saying, Dave?
Guys, we're talking with Boris Said right now. He did not get in the car that time. Want to repeat what you and I just spoke about. If you got in the car, can you race it at 100%?
Probably not at 100% because I'm a little taller than Tony, and I got in this backup car, and I can fit in it. It's just the steering wheel's kind of pressed against my, you know, legs. So I could probably drive 80%. Just sure that'll help him out. I hear his legs are cramped up pretty bad, and I've tried to race with cramped up legs, and it's not a good thing. So hopefully he can go the whole way, but I'll stand by and hope I get to drive, but I don't like doing it under these circumstances, but hopefully he'll go the whole way. He's a great guy. He's pretty tough. If not, I'm ready to go.
The last word from Tony was, guys, we need to do this, even if he can only get in for a short period of time. Matt?
Terry Labonte had brake problems earlier in the race. He came on the radio telling crew chief Jim Long, it has broken. Something is broken. It will not re-fire.
So trouble's there for another of the Hendrick Motorsports entries here at the Glen today as Terry Labonte is coasting slowly so far. Here's Tony Stewart looking on Michael Waltrip. Be for sixth place. And by the way, Tony restarted in 13th after the shuffle of track position on the pit stops. Jeff Gordon restarted in 15th, and Jeff is now up to 11th. Looking back for Jeff Gordon, here he comes. Bill's got an update on him.
And the bad luck for Hendrick Motorsports may extend to the 24 car. On the radio, Jeff Gordon, I may have a front tire going down. Be ready, it's acting funny. So the crew and the driver, watch it carefully.
Man.
So Jeff
Stewart,
Gordon,
no. Taking a look on Michael.
I was going to say Jeff Gordon stays out and yet moves up to the 10th spot, bypassing Brendan Gaughan to pick up that position in this last lap. Seeing the wireless race talk poll, your opinions on the most significant safety innovation in NASCAR over the past year. BP, they agree with you.
I think that I swayed the folks, didn't I?
I don't think you swayed them. I think that they're just right.
Yeah, thank you very much,
and
folks.
And you're just right.
Because
on that one.
Been talking about that for a long, long time, and I applaud NASCAR for the work they've done, and it's just tremendous seeing these guys hit the wall and that impact reduced by about 50%. Because they're going to hit the walls.
Most important, but they're all good moves. I'm glad NASCAR made. They should be all 25%. All equally important.
Coming near the halfway point of today's race at Watkins Glen. 5 different drivers have led today. Tony Stewart's led the most, but Robbie Gordon is out in front right now.
Good look down at Watkins Glen. 2.45 mile road course. There are a lot of tough turns in the race to the chase to the championship. 630 of them are here today. Time for a Visa through the field. Who's running up front? How they got there? Matt Yoakum, that's first.
Robbie Gordon's picked up right where he left off last year. 35 races since he won this event last August, trying to get back to victory lane. He's only pushing that car as hard as it needs to go, telling his team he's out for a Sunday drive.
Way better than these guys. I'm just cruising.
I was hoping you were going to say that. Just keep it up. Okay, now that you're cruising, just safe and catch it. You're doing fine. We're good on one lap past the second window.
And the 29 car was following Robbie Gordon, but now the 20 is trying to chase him down. Dave?
And the 29 of Kevin Harvick running in third position now. Actually, let's switch that. Update quick on Tony Stewart. He's hanging with it. You know, they changed major components on that chassis this morning to try to help Tony's car. If not for that, he might be fighting really hard on that car, as now he goes for the lead on Robbie Gordon.
Man, what a drive through the field. Speaking of through the field, well, for Tony Stewart.
The thing I've noticed on Tony's car is he has great brakes right now. He's outbraking everybody, and he's going in deeper than anybody, so they're not having any brake problems.
Tony Stewart was the leader on the restart. Tony Stewart on the restart at lap 33 was 13th. Lap 42, he's the leader.
Wow.
Let's keep going through the field, Dave.
Now, all my cars are going through the field, Alan. I'm not sure where they are anymore. Harvick falling back a position, but running very, very well. Remember, they pitted under caution on lap 17, stayed out the last time. And in case you wondered, Richard Childress, the owner, did help get that 31 to move over just momentarily to help Harvick lead a lap.
Dave, Casey Mears pitted on lap 14, strategy working for him as well. Next stop in about 10 laps, lap 53, two laps short from making it all the way. They made no changes on their one stop, Matt.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. chasing the target. Casey Mears in the 41 car. Junior says the changes they made to the race car hasn't helped. It is still a little too free trying to tighten it up. He's not happy with the way the 41 car has been cutting him off, Marty.
Whoa.
Joe Nemechek strong too, as we got a new low from Wally. He's currently in the sixth position, having a nice run. They ran the top five at Sonoma until they had a transmission problem. They too pitting about lap 53. Ron Fellows in the seventh position in the middle of that gaggle of cars. So the car has gotten tighter to the right and to the left, but they're moving up to the field. Remember, Fellows started 43rd today, Bill.
Less than 30 seconds ago on the radio, Jeff Gordon in the 24 car. The brakes are shot. There's nothing else I can do, Matt.
Ricky Rudd trying to get himself into a class of Dan Gurney, Marvin Panch, Parnelli Jones, and David Pearson, winning a road course race for the Wood Brothers. They've got 9 wins. He pitted on lap 18. They made a track bar adjustment. He says the car just continues to get better and better, Marty.
Matt Brennan gone, having a nice run up in the top 10, currently in the 10th position. Came on the radio about 15 laps ago, told the guys the changes you made have made the car better. He was tight. Now it's very neutral, Dave.
The 19 car of Jeremy Mayfield, he reported earlier that it was awesome. In fact, in the last pit stop under green, lap 28, they made no changes to help that car. He likes where it is, Matt.
The 97 car of Kurt Busch runs in the 12th position. On his first pit stop, they made a chassis adjustment. He says the car just starts out way too tight and then ends up way too loose. Marty?
Three-time Watkins Glen winner, Matt, gets a lot of encouragement every lap on the radio from his crew chief, Pat Tryson. That is Mark Martin. The car, very good for Mark, handling very well. Not so happy with the engine, though, Bill.
Michael Waltrip going backwards in a hurry, Marty. On the radio, no forward bite, just like those other guys. Matty?
Matt Kent says the car pushes at the top of the hill and is loose on exit, but it's much better than it was in practice on Saturday afternoon. Two career top tens on the road courses, chasing a third today. Dave?
Bobby Labonte reported earlier that Harris's car was just a little bit loose on the right-hand turns, but they didn't make any changes on the last pit stop under green, meaning that the car is handling
a
lot better.
Well, trouble ahead there. Casey Mears has gone around at the exit of the inner loop. Everybody's on the brakes.
Wow, that was a fast recovery.
Where did Brendan Gaughan come from?
Out of the smoke.
Well, out of the smoke, he must have gained 5 or 6 spots.
When Dale Jr. jumped on the brakes and saw, what was that, Kevin Harvick went into the inner loop and then had to stop to keep from getting a penalty. So running positions greatly shuffled as the field comes to halfway. You may see Casey Mears on pit road here. He's looking like... stays on the track. Okay, thought he might have been slowing and making a pit approach. Kirk Shelmerdy with some trouble. That's Tommy Hubert driving Kirk's car.
Oh, he's a lot of damage in front of that car. Dave?
Let's talk about the leader, BP, the 20 car of Tony Stewart. Guess what? They've told Boris said, thank you very much. Our driver told us he's going to gut it out. Tony, leading the race, will stay in the car.
All right.
How could you get out of a car that strong?
Yeah.
So halfway through today at Watkins Glen, the running order in the top 10 shuffled. It's Tony Stewart, though, out in front of second place, Joe Nemechek, whom you ride with. On TNT at Watkins Glen International, with today's NASCAR Nextel Cup Series race having just passed the midway point, we've had wholesale changes in the running order in the top 10 behind leader Tony Stewart. Set that for you in a second. First, let's check the Coca-Cola Racing family. That'll help us set it. See, Kevin Harvick has fallen back to 7th. Kurt Busch Busch is running 10th, Michael Waltrip 12th, Bobby Labonte 15th, all behind leader Tony Stewart. Dale Jarrett suffering bad luck earlier in the race, got hit by Brian Vickers, stuck in the gravel trap. He's a lap down and way back in 34th place. Now, Tony Stewart, the leader, made the charge from 13th up to 1st in about 10 laps after a set of pit stops and a caution before. The man in 2nd place, besides Stewart and his health or not health issues today, the cramps that he was made him consider getting out of the car, but he's changed his mind. Here's Ron Fellows, 43rd to 2nd.
And that's not a big surprise.
No, not really.
We knew that was coming.
Marty. Oh, we got Smoker, Marty.
That would be Ward Burton.
That looks big.
Have not heard a call for a caution flag yet, so we stay under the green. Now the call for the caution. Yellow flag, 42 to go. Oil on the track.
Well, I would guess there is oil on the racetrack because that certainly looked like an engine problem in the zero car.
42 to go. Now what do you do?
Well, I don't think you can make it from here, so...
And I think a lot of people are going to come in after.
And Gamelick, wow, the right side of the 12 car looks like it's flattened in. Beat in.
Okay, let's see if we can figure out what happened.
Or who it was with.
It would be Morgan Shepherd in the 89.
Whoa. Did the same thing Vickers did.
Yep.
Another curb hopper.
Did it happen there? Yeah, it did.
So troubles on the 10th place driver in the championship coming into today. And Ryan Newman running back last on the lead lap right now in 31st place. Talked about this race being critical in that race to the chase. And it might just be. Got a lot of guys struggling here today. Dale Jarrett with troubles and Ryan Newman with his problems. Casey Kane having a decent day. As we check the championship standings, I want to go back and find out what happened to Robbie Gordon because he was running second just after Tony Stewart passed him. He lost about three more spots all in a big hurry, Matt.
Remember, the 31 car was one of the teams that pitted under that first caution back on lap 18. Took left side tires. Robbie telling his team he was wearing out that right front. He was just trying to pedal back, save his tires to his next scheduled stop.
All right, thanks. So now with 40, it'll be 40 to go when they come back around.
When they come by the line, there'll be 40 to go. So the question is, do you pit?
Well, we talk about this almost every weekday. Come in, put four tires, fill it with gas, hoping that you could just come in with gas and go the last stop.
We'll see, Bill.
Hey, Wally.
Yes, Bill.
When you come to these places, you got to stick with your strategy, right? Most of the time. Don't you think, your pit strategy?
Not here.
You don't?
I think it changes too much.
Okay,
so
well,
you can tell me different.
Just for a heads up, the 24 is not stopping. They want to wait 10 more laps. So if you think it's confusing now, just wait till this happens.
Boy. Yeah, that is very confusing. I'm interested in what that one car does. That's what everybody else needs to be looking at right now.
Somebody's going to stop here and take on fuel and start counting the number of caution laps between now and the end of the race and try and stay on track when everybody else pits.
Oh, somebody's probably going to try it, but if this thing goes green, they're not going to make it.
That's right. Exactly.
Because they can only run probably maximum 35, 36 laps on the green flag.
Well, we'll see. Pace truck leading the field back around to the opening of pit road.
See, if you watch races all the time, you realize on some of the oval tracks, we talk about these cars running 100 miles on one tank of fuel. They can't do it here. They can only run about 80, 85 miles on a tank of fuel.
Turn 6, coming around to turn 7. What do we think the second place driver is going to do, Marty?
Well, over the radio, they said we will pit this time, so they're probably going to come down pit road, I would say, Alan.
On Fellows. And the leader, Tony Stewart, coming to where pit road will be opened, and let's see what he does.
Sure looks like he's going to pit road, no? Is he?
Can't make the commitment line by now. Stewart stays out. Nemechek stays out. Gordon stays out, as told by Mr. Weber, and as advertised by Marty. Ron Fellows is in. Robbie Gordon is in. a lot of the lead lap cars. Matt?
Bobby Gordon will be two laps shy of making it. In fact, owner Richard Childress made the call. They were going to stay out. Richard said, no, let's pit. Let's get a full of fuel. To Marty.
Martin Truex Jr.'s Busch Series crew pitting Ron Fellows today. Says a little tighter in the right-handers and the left-handers. They make an air pressure adjustment, trying to help that out. They are four laps short from making it all the way on fuel, hoping for caution for Fellows. Obviously, they have a fast car.
And the 29 of Kevin Harvick is in. Todd Berry, the crew chief, always a gambler on fuel on these road course races. No changes to the 29 this time. Four tires.
Check the order they came off pit road in a moment. Looked like Ron Fellows lost a couple of spots. We'll see where those guys who pitted line up for the restart order when we come back to the Glen. Coming to the restart here at Watkins Glen, New York. NASCAR on TNT with the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series and a really topsy-turvy strategy situation set up. Tony Stewart, the race leader, he and 12 others did not stop under this caution. They'll have to stop again under the green, probably in about 10 more laps. Robbie Gordon, first off the pit road, lined up 14th on the restart, hoping for enough caution flag laps between now and the finish so that his fuel will make it to the checkered flag and he can win the race.
Green. The Fellows lost a lot of positions there in the pits. And once again, they all just fan out as they try to get down to turn one.
Second place, Jeff Gordon under Joe Nemechek.
Looks like he has
somebody
it.
Got turned around there.
Scott Limmer.
I saw somebody get booted.
No caution yet. He's rolling, will stay green. So Gordon got second, Mayfield got third, Nemechek kicked back to fourth, followed by Kurt Busch and Mark Martin. All of those drivers not stopping under the yellow flag. We investigate the incident.
Well, let's see if we can see what happened down there. Wimmer's on the outside.
He just locked it up.
Wow, right in front of Robbie Gordon.
Yeah, nobody touched him. So, see him right there. Wheel hopped it.
Yeah. See that left rear tire jumping up and down?
Yep.
Kevin Harvick riding alongside Robbie Gordon coming into this.
Wow. That was close.
Yeah.
That's one of those things that makes you just believe, okay, it's my day. So Gordon able to hold off Harvick through that. As you see the charge of the guys who made the pit stops, here comes Ron Fellows right behind them. Let's talk about this fuel strategy. Can they make the finish, Matt?
Robbie Gordon at this point of the race, Allen is two laps short, but when he was told the number of laps, he said, well, we have pitted. We have fresh tires. The other best car in this race is at the front of the field. He will have to pit. All we will have to do is a splash of fuel. I like where we are sitting.
I hope he's not forgetting about Ron Fellows.
Yeah.
He pitted and had a very good race car just before that last caution. And runs only two spots behind him.
So I guess that is a good point. If they have to stop, all these leaders are going to have to stop and change four tires. Robbie may have to stop, but he, as he said, will just put a splash of fuel, just 6-7 seconds in the pits, rather than 15 seconds it's going to take for the leader.
The first micro power shaving system from Gillette is new M3 Power, the new power behind the Gillette Young Guns. We checked the standings of the drivers in the Young Guns program. And note that all were in the top 10 in the championship standings at the start of today's race, some faring better than others here at Watkins Glen. Jimmy Johnson out with an engine failure, Ryan Newman with brake problems. So the stories as the race stands, Robbie Gordon, Ron Fellows, do they have enough fuel to make the finish? When do these guys in front of them stop, and how does the track position all shake out? As we ride with Kyle Petty in 11th spot. Kyle Petty making his 700th NASCAR Nextel Cup start here at Watkins Glen today. He's been around for a little while, it's pretty fair to say, since back in 1980. We talked with Kyle earlier this weekend about what the number 700 means to him.
to be in a group like Ricky Rudd, who's run 800 and some races, and Terry Labonte, and my father, who's run over 1,000, and guys like that, to move into that group, I don't know if it says much about your driving, but it says at least they couldn't run you off. You were hard-headed enough that they didn't run you off. So it is pretty cool. And it's nice to come in a place I really enjoy racing, like Watkins Glen. So it's not a headache to come here. I enjoy running here.
Kyle, the 1992 winner here at the Glen.
And right now he's losing 10th, 11th, and Junior thought about trying to take 12th away from him, but did not.
Yeah, I think he did.
Oh, did he? He did, yes.
Remember, these guys coming through, Kyle, have fresh tires.
Tires, exactly.
Yeah, Kyle, talking further about 700 start, he said, what's different most between then when I started and now, the competition? He said, today, any one of 30 cars, maybe more than 30, could win the race on any given Sunday. Back then, maybe 8, maybe 10 at most.
That's a fair statement.
So Kyle hanging on back there in 13th spot, and we check the gap from first place Tony Stewart to second place Jeff Gordon.
Jeff Gordon just can't do anything. He's over 2 seconds behind Tony Stewart right now.
So Stewart out in front has led the most laps of any other driver today. Question is, how will the strategy play out in determining the winner? Robbie Gordon, Ron Fellows on pit road. Matt?
Topping off the 31 car, Ron Linnell plugs the fuel in, and he is out of here. They should be good to go for fuel from here on out, Marty.
Matt running 19th. Ron Fellows comes in. They need about 3.5 seconds of fuel to get him out already behind the 31 car. They said that was their only play. Dave?
Chassis adjustment for Bobby Labonte. Still very loose on the right-handers. Hackett full of fuel. Send him on his way.
Bobby, one of the drivers who did not pit earlier under the caution flag. So now the real race is going to be when Tony Stewart comes onto pit road, watching when Tony comes off, where he falls in with Robbie Gordon and Ron Fellows. How about the 20 strategy? Oh, here he comes, Dave. Stewart to pit road.
That's exactly what I was going to tell you guys next. They want to stay out until this lap, lap 57, as he comes by the start-finish line. That gets them in their fuel window. They were asking him to conserve fuel earlier. He won't have to do that anymore. But that was while he was leading, and or while he was trying to hold off Gordon. As he got out in front, he was able to do that a little bit more. Here they go. He said, I didn't want any changes on the car. The car is coming to me. And as we found out, Tony's health is coming to him as well. He feels better. He feels like he can stay in it and win this race. Four tire change, no adjustments to the chassis.
Can you imagine that changing four tires? Because he's going to be a long way behind Robbie Gordon, those other cars that just stopped for a splash of gas.
As they go down towards turn one, and Tony's coming up to speed off the pit lane, Robbie Gordon is in turn one. This is going to be close.
Yeah, but Stewart's on new tires. That was a great move, I think, on their part.
They had a big enough lead on Robbie Gordon. They could do it, get out in front with four tires. So it looks like they are really in good shape coming out Tony Stewart in the 20 car.
So Greg Zipidelli with the strategy call that's gotten Tony Stewart track position on Robbie Gordon. We believe both now have fuel to the finish. You see Ron Fellows lurking back there, waiting on Jeff Gordon to make his final pit stop. Gordon the leader now that Stewart has come in. And Gordon about a half a lap ahead of these guys on the track. So that little exchange might have been the big turning point of the race right there. Here's Mark Martin in for his stop. Marty?
Well, Mark Martin hits pit road. He has not said a word about the chassis on this run, so Pat Tryson has decided to come in, take on four tires, pull a tear away off the windshield. That's the only change for the six car, four tires and fuel.
A little trouble on the left rear, a little bit slow. 14, 16 seconds.
Don't forget, for the pit crews here at Watkins Glen, they do something they don't do anyplace else all year long. They go to the left side of the car first. Everything's backwards, basically. They all practice it, they all work with it, but it's still not normal for what they're used to doing.
Not normal. Like you, Alan. Not normal.
If you didn't take advantage of that opportunity, I'd have been disappointed in you, Wally. Four-time Watkins Glen winner, Jeff Gordon. Is this the lap for the pit stop? Yes. Bill?
Four tires, guys. One round on the right there, four tires.
Jeff Gordon's car is not running that well. It's really worse on the left-handers. You can see the brake dust coming off the front and the rear tires. And again, these guys have swapped the rear and front tire changers. The guy that normally does the front does the rears here. And the guy that normally does the rear tires is working the front. Good stop for Gordon, making sure they get all the fuel in it. Now he's on his way.
He's having some trouble. That's going to cost him.
He really is. Had trouble getting off pit road. Sounded like he's in second gear or something.
Tony Stewart has just gone by Jeff Gordon while Jeff runs the pit road speed limit of 35. There you see Stewart and Robbie Gordon.
And Ron Fellows. And several and a host of others.
Yeah, you lose a couple of seconds like that in pit lane, and it's a lot when it all said and done. Tony Stewart made up a lot of ground there.
Wow. Jeff lost a lot of spots.
So what he needs now is a caution to come out, allow him to close up
right
to Tony Stewart and regroup. Here's your leader pending his final pit stop, by the way. Kurt
and that's
Busch.
Why they all stopped on the green flag, exactly what you're talking about. Hope the caution flag will come out and they can make up all that space free. That's why Kurt Busch has to stop on the green flag.
One third of the race yet to go. Here's Kurt Busch in for his final pit stop. Dale Earnhardt Jr. becomes the leader as things continue to cycle around. Matt?
The 97 car is in. Dale Earnhardt Jr. will come to pit road next time by. Tire change and chassis adjustment on the 97. They still continue to try to dial this race car in. They go to work on the right side of the car. The mud guys in the A pit are up on the wall waiting for Jr. The 97's away.
Left front fender on that 97 car repaired after a practice crash yesterday here at Watkins Glen. And Kurt Busch looking to see where his strategy shuffles him out. Kurt seventh in the championship standings, only 104 points ahead of 11th starting the day. Five races to go in the race to the chase. Now there's the leader, Dale Jr.
And he's got to come to pit road. He can't sit out there and wait till a caution flag comes out, because he'll have to start behind all these guys that have pitted earlier.
All we're going to do is a flash. Don't be flying those tires. Coming in. We come only in here.
Tony Urie Jr.
Oh, don't miss pit road.
There you see the 8 signboard for Dale Jr. just past the end of the guardrail.
They're just taking gas. Didn't seem like much.
No, sure did. Matt?
They were waiting as long as they could to make sure, Benny and Wally, that if they got a green-white checkered situation, they would have enough fuel to be in that situation and go to victory lane. On the previous stop, Junior said he had no grip, the car wouldn't turn, and just could not come up off the corner. They made an air pressure adjustment, taking a half a pound out of both rear tires and a track bar adjustment to try to help that race car. He hasn't said anything about the handling since.
Great strategy. He's in second spot right now. Oh, he's right behind Tony Stewart.
Remember, Junior stopped under the caution flag at lap 49.
So who's leading the thing now?
That was a splash off.
That'd be Brendan.
That would be Brendan gone.
All right, Matt Kenseth is in second.
And then Casey Mears will be third. Marty?
Well, Alan, here's the benefit of being 30th in the championship standings. Brendan gone, the 77, two laps short from making it all the way. Shane Wilson tells me about as long as they can, because they have nothing to lose. They catch a couple caution laps. Brendan made it stay out front all day.
So what's Matt Kenseth thinking? Same thing, because he's safe. You know, you feel like he's kind of safely into the top 10. Maybe he's going to gamble.
Had an almost caution a second ago, VP.
Oh, see the 16 and 40 close to each other.
Yeah, imagine that.
Gee whiz. Guess I wish I could have seen the start of that.
Doesn't look like today that the 40 car had anything to do with it, Wally. Biffle just got in the corner to our, it looked like.
So there's the race for the lead. Brendan gone, Matt Kenseth. Strategy still playing out and shuffling up the running order here at the Glen. Cup Series is Watkins Glen International, the famed New York road course, where Brendan gone is leading Sirius Satellite Radio at the Glen. That's the name of today's race. He's out in front of Casey Mears, the new second place driver. Matt Kenseth just ducked onto pit road under the green flag seconds ago for what would be his final stop in the race. And we'll check where Kenseth comes out.
as the field cycles back around across the start-finish line. Go ahead, BP.
Is it time?
Yes, sir.
Cue the duck.
It's time for our Aflac NASCAR Nextel Cup trivia question. Who is the only Cup champion competing today without a top five finish on a road course? Can you come up with that? He's not leading, by the way.
No.
All right, I'll give you a hint, because you can think on this one for a while. It took me some time. Survey says the defending series champion.
Best finish on a road course has been eight.
Yep.
That's amazing.
Jeff Gordon, of course, one of the former series champions in today's race with eight road course wins, but Matt hasn't broken into the top five quite just yet. Come back and set the strategy to the finish for you in a minute. Brendan Gaughan leads at Watkins Glen. New leader here at Watkins Glen, it is Casey Mears. 41 car slipping by Brendan Gaughan a half a lap ago in the inner loop to take over the top spot.
Wow, Brendan Gaughan is gone.
He is gone. Something is up with that 77 car.
Here's the pass for the lead.
Brendan just kind of moves over. I think he feels like something is going wrong.
And so that was the change for the lead in the inner loop. Now they come down to turn number six.
Explains where he went.
Okay.
Brendan putting his off-road truck experience to use.
Good job getting out of that gravel.
But it's cost him 5 seconds to the race leader, Casey Mears. So Casey now one of nine different drivers to lead the race today as we check our Harley-Davidson lap leaders. Tony Stewart leading the most laps today, a third of the race. He's been out in front. Right now, though, he runs back in fifth position, 12 seconds behind Casey Mears.
That may be enough. It'd be enough of a cushion.
If there's no caution.
Yeah, no, I'm just saying, if it goes green right now, that may be enough of a lead.
So here's Casey Mears, guy who won the pole position for the Brickyard 400, then had kind of a struggling day, including a late flat tire that dropped him back to 26th at the finish. Kind of a disappointing day. Remember here, last year in this race, he was fifth with nine laps to go and spun out in turn one. Wound up finishing 32nd.
Dave Blaney went by the third place car. Here goes Tony Stewart, fourth place.
So Stewart's got to make up all that ground if it goes green to try to catch Casey Mears.
But he's going to pit. Casey Mears is going to stop for gas.
Not that they say.
Okay.
Drama in the final miles here at Watkins Glen, perhaps. Someone will go to victory lane later today. Will it be Casey Mears with his first NASCAR Nextel Cup Series win?
At the road course at Watkins Glen, NASCAR on TNT, the 22nd race of the season, laps winding down. The big question, up and down pit road, who can reach the finish on fuel, and when exactly will that finish be? The race scheduled for 90 laps. Let's take you through the field, starting with a 41 at Casey Mears. And Marty Snyder's got that car.
We'll have the most popular saying on the radio, save fuel and trouble on the racetrack, Brendan Gaughan.
Oh, second place runner Brendan Gaughan is stuck in the gravel trap, and the yellow flag is out. Watch those wheels spin as he tries to get out.
In
but
pain.
I can tell you, Brendan, it's pointless.
Forget it.
Okay.
The floor, locked him up.
Did you say brake pedal went to the floor?
Yeah, brake pedal went to the floor and locked him up. On the rocks with Brian Vickers, Dale Cherry, Sadler, and now Brendan Gaughan.
Not a group you want to
you
be involved.
You told them not to go in the rocks.
I said at the very top, don't do this.
So from second place to potentially a lap down, here's what happened. Watch him coming at you.
Man, he's sideways back in the straightaway.
Yeah, right when he got on the brakes, that thing went sideways. Look at the rocks coming out already.
From the other off
the
course.
Other rock excursion.
Stop short. Oh, no.
Just about 6 feet.
Yep. That's too bad. Having a good race in front of his sponsors, home fans, Rochester, New York, home base of Eastman Kodak. But not going to be the kind of finish he was hoping for Brendan Gaughan. While the pace car gathers up the field, we'll check our Napa field summary. Nine leaders on the day. Tony Stewart has led the most laps. A
Other leaders today, Jeff Gordon, Robbie Gordon, Brendan Gaughan, Casey Mears, Earnhardt Jr., Harvick, Kurt Busch, and Jimmy Johnson. This now the fifth caution flag of the race, this latest one. And just seven cars out of the race. Ward Burton and Morgan Shepherd, the latest of them, both to the garage with engine troubles. Greg Biffle may be headed that way as well, as we're under the yellow flag here at Watkins Glen on the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series.
Where are you at out there? I will not go.
Turn the lights off. Cap terminal, pointing to turnover.
All clear.
Watkins Glen, New York, NASCAR on TNT with the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series. It never fails. We try to do through the field, and the yellow flag comes out. So let's do what we can under caution on pit road and hear from some crew chiefs downstairs. Marty, you're first.
Jimmy Ellidge, crew chief for Casey Mears. That is not what you wanted to see, the caution, because you could have made it all the way on green flag racing, but now Tony Stewart's on your rear bumper. How much does that hurt?
Well, I'd much rather took my chances on running out of gas than having him behind us. He's been a lot better than we have, but I heard he wasn't feeling good. Maybe he'll get sick or something, so I hate to wish anything bad on him, but regardless, whatever happens here, we've had a great day, and we've had a good last few weeks of sitting on the pole at the Brickyard in Pocono, and maybe we can hang on and win this thing, maybe not. If not, hopefully we can get out of here with a good top five finish, and real proud of all the guys and everybody for Team Target.
Casey Mears with a shot at his first win, Dave.
I'm actually being zip-tied to the 20 pit box right now, so I might be here for a while, guys. Greg Zipidelli, your driver, has gone through so much today. He hadn't said much on the radio lately. It looks like, though, he can win this race, doesn't he?
Yeah, he's doing a heck of a job in this Home Depot Chevrolet. It's a pretty strong race car. It's been good off the truck all weekend. He's been on his game, and, you know, our fuel mileage has been off a little bit, but kind of stuff's been falling to where we, you know, we'll give up the lead and come in 15th, and he'll just drive his way back to the front. So, there's a couple good cars behind us. Should be a decent race here, the last 15 to go. We'll keep our fingers crossed and hope that he's saving a little something for these boys.
All right, Alan, back to you.
Dave, we've learned this lesson now a couple of weeks in a row.
Some of us have learned.
Be very wary.
When
I was
you go
told
to the
by my producer
pit.
To go interview the crew chief. So what can I say?
And now the crew chief wants you to get down.
Yeah,
get out of his way. Matt.
Dave, I bet if you looked in the hands of Scott Deal, the car chief, he has a few tie wraps and probably some wire cutters that he'll loan you in a minute. But let's talk to here in the 31. Chris, now, Robbie wanted to come in and pit for tires. You talked him out of it. Why?
Oh, track position is so important here. It's kind of the three most important things, track position. So put the singular wireless Monte Carlo in position here and let him have a run at it.
But you laid out why, car by car ahead of him, why he needed to stay out.
Yeah, we're better than a lot of cars in front of us, so see what he does here at the end.
The only issue the 31 car has, he doesn't have as good a brakes as he had earlier in the race, but they have still talked to him, Bill, about we don't want anybody else in that seat than you. We think you can still pull it off and get your third road course win.
Thanks, Matt. With Robbie Loomis, who's watching for Jeff Gordon to come by, can your guy get back to the front?
Tell you, it's going to be extremely tough. You know, Tony's been extremely strong all day, but we feel good about getting up there with him. We got a lot fresher tires than the guys ahead of us. We're just going to have to be careful and be smart. We've got 15 laps to do it, see what we get with the DuPont Chevrolet.
All right. Robbie Loomis, crew chief for Jeff Gordon. They can make it, by the way, to lap 94, Marty.
Bill, the caution, a big break for Ron Fellows. Kevin Mannion, he's had the fastest car in that last run, pretty clearly. Can he win it from fourth?
Oh, yeah, no question about it. You know, Ron's been extremely helpful to this team and the company, and really, really fast this last set of tires he really likes.
All right, they still think they have a shot, and from fourth, I think they can get it done, Alan.
It's going to be very interesting to find out. So here we come to a restart that'll be with 15 laps to go. You've got Casey Mears leading the race, trying to stretch his fuel, but with his 11-second advantage wiped out by the caution flag. The next car in line is Brendan Gaughan, but he's now a lap down after getting pulled out of the gravel trap. Then you get Tony Stewart second, Dave Blaney third, and Rapid Ron Fellows in fourth.
Casey Mears is a sitting duck.
Yeah.
And pretty much so is Dave Blaney.
That
so Ron Fellows
guess.
Needs to get by Blaney quick, and Stewart needs to get by Mears quick, and, you know, get away from each other.
How quick do you think? Turn one?
Are they I would say turn one is going to be exciting again.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. And don't forget Robbie Gordon lurking back in seventh. We just heard from his crew chief. Here comes the restart. 15 to go at the Glen. Nice job, Brendan Gaughan, getting out of the way.
It's a good move.
Robbie Gordon.
Good move.
Nice move, Robbie.
Dale Jr. under Ricky Rudd.
You always know Robbie's going to do that. He does it everywhere.
Got one of them. Rudd was able to hold him off. Robbie up to sixth. Tony Stewart did clear the lap traffic. You saw Brendan Gaughan get out of the way. But Ron Fellows not able to get around Dave Blaney. And for the lead to the inner loop, Tony Stewart.
Man, is that 20 car strong.
It stops, too. Now, Tony has got to go. He's got to get as much track in between him and Ron Fellows. Ron Fellows is fast. He probably has the fastest car out there. But this is a good situation for Tony. Ron's going to have to get by these cars.
By the way, Brendan Gaughan, just we talked about getting out of the way on the restart. Transmission is locked up on his car. He's gone behind the wall.
Here's Fellows. There's one.
It's the third. I just see this getting interesting because Fellows on the longer runs really seem to hold more of his speed than some of the other guys. Robbie Gordon going to try Ricky Rudd again. That's for fifth.
Smoking one of the inside tires.
And Dale Jr. trying to follow him through underneath Rudd. So Gordon to fifth, Jr. to sixth, Rudd to seventh, Jeff Gordon sits eighth.
Robbie Gordon, I don't think he can do anything with Fellows and Tony Stewart. I think they have better tires than he does.
I agree.
Here's Jeff Gordon on Ricky Rudd. Gets himself a spot.
But Tony Stewart is getting away from Ron Fellows.
There's the gap. First, second, third. Stewart, Mears, Fellows. And we'll check our AOL top speeds at the line and check the last lap times among the front runners.
Bobby Gordon is having some troubles there under braking. He's smoked the tires again.
Let's see. Tony Stewart, fastest among the top 10. Here's Fellows for second.
Oh, baby. That was picture perfect, wasn't it?
Exactly. Oh.
You draw up in the dictionary a perfect pass in turn one, that would be the photograph you'd use.
So 13 to go. Fellows gets to second. Let's check on Robbie Gordon, Matt.
Alan, moments ago, we told you that Robbie Gordon was complaining about his brakes. That's why you're seeing him start to lock up. They keep each spotter around the course, keeps telling Robbie, be smooth, be smooth. You're locking up your brakes, still trying to hold on to a decent run today with what was a very fast race car.
And Matt said spotters. These teams use about three spotters stationed around the racetrack to warn them of trouble on the racetrack in front of them.
See if he smokes them again going into this corner. He did last lap. No, it's pretty clean that lap.
See Jeff Gordon there running in seventh place. Remember, Jimmy Johnson went out of this race earlier with an engine failure. And so Jeff Gordon, if he's able to hold on to this top finish, will become the new championship leader here at Watkins Glen today.
But we aren't interested in that, are we, Wally?
No, we're not. When are they ever going to learn?
Jeremy Mayfield, there we see it. Jeff Gordon goes by the 31 car, takes over that position. Jeremy is now in 10th spot. But how much of a lead does he have? As we look at 11 through 15, 10 points over Newman, 26. Now, Martin back in the hunt, only 79 back.
Boy, it's going to be close.
Oh, man, isn't it exciting? And Junior got by the 31 car, Robbie Gordon.
Yeah. Go ahead, Matt.
Talking to the car chief on the 8, Tony Urey Jr., they are not only good to go on fuel, guys, they are good to go if we get a GWC, green, white, checker.
Now that's still on the minds of some of these people.
I think now most of the cars in the top, except with the exception of Casey Mears, will be okay with a green white checker. But I think Mears, I still think he might struggle to get to lap 90 on his fuel.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. started this race in third position. Under the car.
caution flag at lap 50, then came in to splash off, splash and dash, top off the fuel at lap 61.
Mark got pinched there by Robbie.
That's for the seventh position. But more importantly for Mark Martin, it's three more points.
I'm sorry, four more points closer to that top 10.
Yeah.
Mark, three-time Watkins Glen winner, started today in 15th place. And he's running eighth right now.
He's struggling to get through the carousel, yeah. Sounds like.
Yeah, well, it looked like Robbie was, too. Made up a little bit of ground on Robbie there. Mark's very smooth. Very smooth road course driver.
Yeah, he's not one of these guys tossing it over the curbs and slamming the gears. He really drives precisely. Tony Stewart leading with 10 laps to go. Dave?
Yeah, can he beat Ron Fellows, the road course ace, on what is perhaps not Tony's best day physically? Remember, he got this road course thing down pretty quick in 1999 when he was a rookie. He went to the Bondurant Driving School to improve his skills. Then he won at Sears Point in 2001, only his fifth road course start. And then, of course, he had a win here at Watkins Glen in 2002. Tony can run the right and left turns of a road course. Marty?
Dave, the man chasing him, Ron Fellows, has won here in the Busch Series. He's won here in the Craftsman Truck Series, but he's never won here in NASCAR Nextel Cup competition. He has said nothing on the radio this time. In fact, you only hear a spotter talking to Ron. All they've said, be smooth, hit your marks. If we do get a green-white checkered, they can make it on the fuel.
Tony is driving away from Fellows right now. He has been faster than Ron Fellows consistently the last three or four laps.
I don't think there's any question that this car has been the fastest car today. Yep. Right? Early laps, Tony started fourth. He moved up. He took the lead, on lap two? And has been out in front for more than a third of this race.
And you see, Tony's using less racetrack, which is a good thing. If you can go that fast, you're not sliding the car. Fellows, these guys behind him are using the curves. They're using a lot more racetrack than Tony is. Dave.
And just a reminder what a big pickup that was for this team. Yesterday morning in practice, they were chattering the rear tires. The car was very, very loose. They made a lot of changes to that car to make it right for Tony.
Tony Stewart has never finished worse than 15th on a road course in his Nextel Cup career. Looking for his second win here at Watkins Glen today, 8.5 laps away. His lead over Ron Fellows opening up to now 2.5 seconds. As the Canadian Fellows puts in a game effort, but is coming up a little bit shy.
And how proud would Tony Stewart be of this victory if he could look up in the mirror and see Ron Fellows, recognized as one of the best road racers in the country, behind him and unable to catch him.
I know Ron will be disappointed if he ends up finishing second to Tony, but boy, what a drive. He started last today. He's running second. So smooth, so good behind the wheel of these cars. And you heard the report from their team's pit about what a help that Ron Fellows has been to the corporation, Kevin Mannion saying. Ron doing a lot of work to help this team develop their road racing cars, which has helped this driver, Dale Jr., as well as Michael Waltrip. Go ahead, Matt.
Fellows has certainly helped the entire DEI road course program. Now, Dale Earnhardt Jr., last three road course finishes, an 11th, a 3rd, and an 11th, working on another top five now. Now, to add to that list of items we told you earlier that's wrong with this car, add the brakes. He keeps telling his team, remind me to keep pumping up the brakes. They're trying to hold on for a top five finish, Marty.
Patty, what an outstanding day for Dave Blaney. Currently in the sixth position in his last ride in the 30 car. I talked to him earlier this week about what he might do after this week. He said he didn't know. He may work out things with Bill Davis, maybe go back there. But he said if nothing else, he can go be crew chief for his 10-year-old son, Ryan. They have had a terrific day today. The best finish the 30 car has ever had is a fifth at Michigan last year. Currently Blaney in sixth. Trouble on the racetrack. Bill.
Transmission trouble on the 24. Do you have any gears at all, Jeff? They're asking. I just got four, he just told them.
Wow, he's going to get passed by a lot of cars if he passes. That's just,
and they warned about that while he said, be careful, there's a long line of cars coming behind you. He pulls to the right, pulls him by on the left. Boy, what a disappointing day for Hendrick Motorsports.
Jeff's going to go from fourth to who knows where in the final seven laps of this race. As Mayfield just went by him, so Gordon's back to ninth and dropping.
Martin looked like he got by the 30 car, but he might have made contact with the 30 doing it. Has some damage to the left front fender, some smoke off that left front tire on the 6.
Boy, Jeff really boxed these guys up behind him. Well, he's definitely going to go to 26, if not a lap down before this is over.
Here's what Jeff said a minute ago on the team's radio.
Got any gears at all, Jeff?
Right now I got 4.
Got 7 to go. We just got to take care of it best we can.
Robbie Loomis and Jeff. And this racetrack in just 4th gear.
Oh, ooh, that's man. Gonna be... I don't even know if you can keep the minimum speed up in 1 gear around this place.
Just going to be slow. Ron Fellows has chopped a little bit off of Tony Stewart's lead. About a half a second. But, well, that's a lot to make up in a short period of time.
It goes back and forth. I mean, one lap, Ron Fellows will be a half a second faster than Tony Stewart. Then the next lap, Tony Stewart will be a little bit faster than Ron.
Last week, Ron Fellows won a sports car race at his home track, Mossport, Canada, driving a Cadillac sedan. He said that was a lot of fun just throwing that car around the racetrack.
Ron is a 44-year-old from Mississauga, Ontario. That's outside of Toronto. Veteran of all kinds of sports car racing, former Le Mans winner for the factory Corvette team. And
that was a really nice move of this 12 car. Did you see him just kind of get out of these guys' way and let them settle in? What's my role in 12 car, Dave?
Well, and even tougher to let them go over there, BP, when you're running 10th in the championship coming into today and you're on the bubble for that chase to the championship. But Ryan, all day long, brake problems. They spent numerous minutes in the pits after every pit stop trying to fix that brake problem. And of course, then the big ding on the door that almost sent him for a spin when Morgan Shepherd and him got together. It's been a long day for Newman.
Boy, it does make it for a long day, Dave, when you have brake problems on the road course. Like I said, there's just nothing you can really do. You can try to bleed them in the pits, but normally that doesn't even fix it.
See what happened to Jeff Gordon, that transmission trouble. He goes from leading the NASCAR Nextel Cup points back to second, 31 behind his teammate, Jimmy Johnson.
And for Jeff Gordon, a warning from NASCAR to pick up his pace because he's not meeting that minimum speed you talked about, Wally, a minute ago.
Now, the third place car right now is Casey Mears, the 41 car. This lap for the next one is when he was going to run out of gas. Just want you to know that
okay.
So Fellows doing all he can to try and catch up to Tony Stewart.
Catching him is one thing.
Yeah.
Passing him is the other.
Well, he's chopped another 0.3 seconds off the gap. But time runs short.
Yeah, that 20 car just seems to me right now, it's, I mentioned it earlier in the show, he's really got the car stopping well.
Stewart, one win so far this year. That back at Chicagoland Speedway, a day that was not all pleasant for Tony. And I guess you could say today's not been all pleasant for him either.
It's been miserable for him. He wanted a relief driver. Boris Sid was down there, ready to get in the car, and he decided, well, I'll try to gut it out. And here he is, just a few laps from winning this thing.
A little bit faster on that lap was Ron Fellows.
Hey, Marty.
Yes, BP.
The 41 going to make it, you think?
He is going to make it, BP. I told you, I've checked with Jimmy Elledge 3 times, and when you sent that on the air, I went and checked with Jimmy Elledge for a 4th time.
Yeah.
He said, tell BP, I think we're fine. Don't worry about us.
Okay, there he is.
He's still going.
He's still going. I agree with you.
Casey Mears in position in that 41 car to record his best ever Nextel Cup finish. 7th, 4 times his best finish. He could get his first top 5 today if... As Jimmy and Marty say, he's got fuel to the finish.
That's right.
He's not going to run out of gas.
Okay. I would love to see him have his best finish ever. Because, and Jimmy Elledge, his dad worked with me many, many years ago. I'm pulling for these guys. But I think he's going to run out of gas.
We'll see. Well, here it is. First to second. And that what will be the story at the end of the day here at Watkins Glen on the track. The championship standings may make the headlines tomorrow, but let's see who's going to win the race. Rod Fellows lost a couple tenths of a second to Tony Stewart.
Like I said, it's been going back and forth every other lap.
That last lap. Fellow's a big fan and season ticket holder of the Toronto Maple Leafs.
I think that Tony, he realized, they told him there's three laps to go. I think he's reaching down and finding a little bit special to keep this gap between him and the one car.
And he's doing it. You got to make sure you catch traffic in the right way, not the wrong way, because he could catch a car in the wrong spot, and Rod Fellows will be there.
A broader picture for Tony Stewart. He's got four top five finishes in the last five races, gained 100 points on Jimmy Johnson in the championship, and this team really building some momentum as we get closer to that 10-race chase for the Nextel Cup. Could be really, really tough to handle in those final races, Dave. Dave?
Hey guys, remember we talked about how cars almost never fix themselves. Today, Tony didn't fix himself. Dr. John Gleddy helped him a lot by giving him something for his stomach cramps. Now, this is the doctor that works for the Brunos Racing Team, the sports car racing team that Tony raced with here at Watkins Glen on Friday night. He stayed over for this race as well, and when the call came in that Tony was feeling ill, he knew just what to give him. That's one thing that helped keep Tony in the car today.
That's very nice. See that kid stealing the battery?
Yeah, that's what I was laughing at. You better get out of there quick.
I would not recommend doing that. Pieces fly off race cars. That's why they have those fences for you to stay behind.
He stayed behind it.
No, he stayed behind the guardrail. The spectator fence is another 10 yards farther back. Not too good. Coming to the white flag. What a drive for Ron Fellows today from last to second, but Tony Stewart overcoming the cramps, staying in the race car. We knew he had too good a race car to give it up.
Man, I'm so impressed with this run today.
And now the white flag is up, and we're on the final lap here at Watkins Glen. Another 10 or so gear, 7 corners, plus the inner loop for Tony Stewart to find victory lane. We're assuming he'll find victory lane.
I bet he will.
Today.
And there goes the 41 car, Benny.
Yep, he's still running. White flag. Marty may be right. We'll see.
Well, can we say Jimmy was right?
Jimmy was right. Jimmy Ellis was right. Yeah. Not Marty. Tony, very impressive today.
This is a team that has endured its share of ups and downs, the different things that happen to them, the controversy that seems to just build up and swirl around them from time to time. Last weekend at the Brickyard 400, Tony Stewart not able to come up with the result that he so badly wants at that racetrack. Brushed it off probably as well as he ever has a disappointment at Indianapolis particularly. And here at Watkins Glen today, overcoming the physical cramps that have dogged him throughout the day, and he's going to ride his way to a dominating win. He'll lead half the race today and take his second Watkins Glen checkered flag. Tony Stewart is the winner. Second and a half, margin of victory over Ron Fellows. Stewart leads 46 of the 90 laps. His second win of 2004. And his third victory on a road course. Look at Casey Mears wiggling it to the finish line. He ran out of gas just a couple of hundred yards shy of the checkered flag.
He made it to the end. Congratulations. He lost third spot, but he made it to the end.
Best ever Nextel Cup finish for Casey Mears. So Tony Stewart with his 19th career victory. He and the other top finishers when TNT returns to the Glen. Stewart driving directly into victory lane, and Chevy congratulates Tony and the number 20 Monte Carlo on today's Watkins Glen win. No cars dominated cup racing like the defending manufacturer's champion Chevrolet and American Revolution. Bill Weber's in victory lane with the winner.
And Tony Stewart pulled directly in here and now is going to climb out of the car. Still has his part of his head and neck restraint device on. Has admitted on the radio after the race he does not feel very well, does not plan to stay here in victory lane very long, but is still trying to untie himself from the car, and then he will climb out. So an amazing run for Tony Stewart here today, who, as Benny and Wally and Alan talked about, wanted to get out of the car because he wasn't feeling well, but he made it to the end. And now he does get out of the car as the winner at Watkins Glen. And Tony is gonna walk directly to his motor coach. We're gonna try and catch up to him here. Walk with and not feeling well at all. And they've got a cart for him here. You gonna be okay?
Yeah, we'll be right back.
All right, congratulations. He had said on the radio that when he got to victory lane, he was going to his motor coach for a good 10 minutes. Obviously not feeling well at all.
So we'll let him regroup and then talk to him when he comes back, I guess. We'll see in a minute. Take a break here at Watkins Glen. Tony Stewart is the winner. We'll let him regroup, and we'll talk with he and the other top finishers after this.
How about it?
At Watkins Glen, we wait for Tony Stewart's return to the winner's circle to talk about his victory in today's NASCAR Nextel Cup Series race. Stewart leading 46 of the 90 scheduled laps today, and we show you the finishing order at the bottom of the screen. While we do that, let's talk with some of the other top finishers. We'll begin with Marty.
Alan, Ron Fellow started 43rd today. You finished second. I can't tell whether you're excited or disappointed by that.
I'm disappointed. We finished second before. You know, I got to thank everybody at DEI, Pete, Bono, all the guys. Richie Gilmore, Jeff, just everybody at Kraft Foods, Neil Wafer, Nutter Butter. Wow, we had a really good Chevy, but we had to work hard with that thing. I just didn't have enough left for Tony for that last caution, and all I could do was match his times. It was good. I don't know what we'd do different. It was great. It just wasn't good enough, and man, second again.
Disappointed, Dave?
With Casey Mears, who is not disappointed, especially because of low fuel that last lap. Talk about that.
Yeah, it was pretty wild. Actually, with three to go, the light came on, and I went, oh, no, you know, we're running out of fuel. And Jimmy said we wanted to make a big gamble. You know, we needed to make a big gamble, getting that side of that top five. It's the only chance that we have a run to get inside the championship there at the end. And he made a big gamble, and Jimmy Elledge and the Target crew is what got this top five for us today. We made a big gamble. It worked out for us. And, you know, three laps to go, I got the light. And when I got the white flag, off of turn three again, it died, and that's when the six car got by me, and I just started wiggling it from there on out, and it picked up again and ran all the way to about just before the start-finish line and died again, and then I ran out on the back stretch, and the eight car pushed me back, and I know he didn't mean to get into me that time. That was just an accident, and he was nice enough to push us back, but what a day for us. You know, I'm just real happy for the Target crew. Say hi to Chip and a lot of friends and family back home. Just appreciate everything.
All right, after his Indianapolis pole, follows it up with his first career top five here at Watkins Glen. Marty?
What a strong day for Mark Martin. Came on strong at the end, as you were just talking about. But boy, you had to fight at the beginning of this race to get some track position, didn't you?
It was tough. You know, it's a hornet's nest back there. I tell you, I hate racing back there around 20th spot, man. It's wild. You get stuff tore up in a heartbeat back there. But, you know, Pat Tryson and Wally Brown and this Viagra team worked hard on this Taurus to make it run good at the end of the race. It has been off. We've raced this car three times, and we've been off a little bit, and they really got it wired in. It was strong at the end. I just want to thank Pennzoil and Kraft Foods and everybody. I thank the Lord for a good day. I've had so much bad luck this year. I could see something going wrong on the last lap again.
And he finished one. Finishes in third, Matt.
Well, Jeff Gordon's not going to get that ninth road course win today. Did the transmission go all at once, Jeff, or did you lose one gear after another?
No, it went all at once. We didn't have a car for Tony. He was really strong all day. Well, it wasn't our day. We had a good car, and pulled ourselves back in the top five there, and, you know, we were pretty content with that, and then just went to go into third gear and had nothing and went to fourth and just... I tried second one time after that, and I could just hear the pieces rattling around. So just rode around there in fourth the rest of the way, took what we could get. You know, we knew this going in. It was a gamble, and right now we can afford to do that. I mean, we wanted to win, but we thought that this transmission would give us a little speed. And I mean, I thought it did. It was good for most of the day until it didn't make it to the end.
Disappointing 21st place finish for Jeff Gordon.
Matt, with Dale Earnhardt Jr. now a fifth place finish. They're never easy here, are they, Junior?
No, not today. The car was real good at starting racing. I asked for a little more than I handled on some adjustments, and the car got away from us a little. We kind of got behind them. Hey, Bobbin, we worked hard. We didn't really get it on the racetrack. We got it on pit road. We had a little great pit strategy, and Tony Jr. did some great calls and got me out there. And just tried to dig and keep what we could keep and do what we could do, and we gained some ground on the guys in front of us in the points. So that's a good day.
It takes a complete combination, and they did it today. Alan?
All right, so Dale Earnhardt Jr., and you've heard from all the top five finishers except the race winner. We'll take a break here, come back, show you the finishing results, the very interesting championship standings, and hopefully talk to Tony Stewart. Here are the final results from today's race at Watkins Glen. Tony Stewart with his second win of this season and second here at this historic road course. Von Fellows, another second place finish, as he said a minute ago.
And then Jeremy Mayfield with that seventh place finish. I think you Jeremy Mayfield fans are going to be pleased with what that brought him.
Ricky Rudd, his first top 10 of the season. Jeff Burton's final ride with Roush Racing ends in 12th place today.
Robbie Gordon comes to finish in 16th, Wally.
Yeah, that's going to be a little bit disappointing for him and those guys.
Jeff Gordon, 21st place. Talked to him just a minute ago. 24th place, Dave Blaney, last on the lead lap. And now the guys who are in that race to the chase that had trouble, Ryan Newman, Dale Jarrett.
And Jarrett actually did pretty well to have to get in the sand trap and lose in a lap, finishing the 27th.
And Jimmy Johnson, 40th.
Second week in a row, mechanical failures have taken the championship leader out. So what do those standings look like after race 22 of the season? Johnson hanging on to a lead, but it's just 40 over Jeff Gordon.
I told you Jeremy Mayfield fans would be happy.
A new 10th place driver, BP.
Yes. All right, 11th through 15th, Casey Kane. His teammate moves 24 points behind him. Now Ryan Newman back to 12th. Mark Martin only 72 back.
Very close.
99 points to 15th place.
Ooh, four more to go.
Bill Weber has gone back to the driver's motorhome lot. Bill?
And back here, followed Tony Stewart back here. You saw him get on the golf cart. They drove him back here. He is inside his motor coach. They're bringing him a fresh fire suit, a driving suit for him to change into. But I'm told by his camp that he is not feeling very well at all, and it could be quite a while before he comes out of that motor coach. So a gutsy effort for Tony Stewart today, able to get his second win here at Watkins Glen, his third road course victory. But right now, not anywhere near in a condition to celebrate it, feeling very ill inside his motor coach behind us. So, Alan, that's the story from down here. Congratulations to him, but the celebration may come tomorrow.
Okay, Bill. Thanks. We appreciate the effort. And that's going to do it from Watkins Glen. Dominating performance is right for Tony Stewart today, and now we move on to Michigan in the race to the chase, down to just four events before the cutoff. Triple header weekend, Bud Pole qualifying Friday at 3 Eastern, Saturday 1 Eastern, NASCAR Busch Series racing from Michigan, then next Sunday, 1:30 Eastern, NASCAR Nextel Cup racing from Michigan, starting with Discover Card Countdown to Green all next weekend, NASCAR on TNT. And next on both the East and West Coasts, the original movie, Evel Knievel. Tony Stewart, a dominating performance today here on the road course. He led over half the race, scoring his second win of 2004, despite feeling very much under the weather. See you in Michigan.